So welcome inside Memorial Stadium, sold out for the 310th consecutive time. We're in Lincoln, Nebraska, where tonight the 8th-ranked Nebraska Cornhuskers will be hosting the Kansas Jayhawks in the final meeting between these two teams as members of the Big 12 Conference. Well, hi, everybody. I'm Dave Armstrong, along with Gary Reasons. And Gary comes, and Nebraska comes in with that 8th ranking nationally. They also come in off a very close win against Iowa State in overtime. They escaped with a win there, but they did not have Martinez as their quarterback in that game. He only played one play. Good to have him back in the lineup.
Well, Taylor Martinez, he's just been a superb quarterback and a young freshman doing great things here for this football team. And when he's on his game, this team really sparks. And good to have Taylor Martinez back in the lineup. He's practiced all week and they feel like he's able to go. His numbers on the season, what he's been able to do passing the ball and running the ball, are freshman phenomenal numbers. Look at his numbers there per game. First, these are all-time records at Nebraska, folks, and first also in passing per game. He'll get over 1,000 yards rushing in those 12 touchdowns on the ground. He's also got some through the air. Shows you the capability that this young quarterback has. Hey, he's fast, he's electric, he can beat you a couple of ways. He can throw it down the field to his capable receivers, and also he can break you down running the football. A couple of 80-yard scampers already to his credit this season, and he's making big play after big play. They'll look for him to do that tonight. I think that he's excited to get back here and play in front of this home crowd.
Taylor Martinez did not start last week because of a sore ankle. It's still not 100%. So if he can't go the entire game, they have some able backups.
Well, they got a couple of quarterbacks, Zach Lee and Cody Green, both of them experienced quarterbacks. And Zach Lee, the senior, I think he's more of a passing quarterback, but he's got an issue with his hand. So if there was a problem there, I think Cody Green, who started the game last week, would probably get the nod. He's a dual threat type of a quarterback. They're in capable hands either way, but I think they're really excited to have Taylor back in the lineup.
So for Nebraska, with that escape against Iowa State last week, different story for Kansas. They've had a tough year, but what a week and what a comeback last week against Colorado.
That's a character builder for your team. Turner Gill's got to be excited about how his team fought back in that fourth quarter, down in that football game. He's coaching his heart out on the sideline to get his guys going the right way, and guess what? They responded. 35 points in that fourth quarter is a record, folks, for Kansas, and I tell you, with one of the second largest comeback in NCAA history, and he spread the ball around them. Part of the team pitched in. The defense got a score late in the ball game, and the offense was just superb. Now, Quinn Meekum, who got the start in that football game, the second start of the season, played well, very efficient, and he orchestrated that. So we're excited to see him play tonight with this Kansas Jayhawk team.
Well, Meekum was perfect in the second half. He was 12 for 12. He was great. But again, as you pointed out, those 35 points scored in the fourth quarter, that's the second most in NCAA history and the biggest comeback ever for KU.
I think it's a good thing you can build on. Turner Gill's got to be very happy about the character that his football team played, and he's preached that to his football team.
Now, Turner Gill knows all about Nebraska. Of course, he starred here as a quarterback, three-time All-Big Eight player as a quarterback in the early 80s. Coming back here now as the head coach of the Jayhawks, this must be an emotional day for him.
And I think it's a lot to say about this team, these fans and how they actually responded to him. Tom Osborne, the athletic director here at the University of Nebraska, before the game did a video, and it played on the screen here in the stadium. And all these fans, they erupted. They want to welcome him back. He's their beloved son.
And Turner still knows and remembers well what this is all about. Walking through the tunnel, getting ready to come out into Memorial Stadium. Guides the Nebraska Cornhuskers out onto the field here at Memorial Stadium. When we come back, we'll visit with Turner Gill, a beloved son of the Nebraska Cornhuskers. That's coming up next. Now Bo Pelini guiding these Nebraska Cornhuskers to this 8-1 record. He has won at least 9 games in his first 2 years. Could get that 9th win here today.
Yeah, it'd be a big win for him to get there, and that's a plateau that he'd like to reach. They kind of set the stage for the end of the season here for a championship.
Third member of our broadcast crew here today, Jim Rose, who's standing by with Turner Gill.
As a sophomore, you took this field and led Nebraska to a come-from-behind victory against Auburn, and that was the start of a love affair between a group of fans and one player. How do you feel coming back to Nebraska as the coach of another team?
Well, weird. I guess it's unique. But again, I'm happy for the opportunity I have, and right now I'm all Rock Talk Jayhawk.
Turner, what did your Nebraska experience do to build you into the coach that you've become?
Well, it taught me how to teach young men and develop young men, how to play the game of football, but also how to play the game of life. And I thank Coach Osborne and all the people and all the fans here in Nebraska. Thank you.
That's Coach Turner.
Thanks, Coach. You can tell how much this place is rocking, Gary.
It was definitely rocking.
There's no chance for that camera to stay steady.
You know, just an emotional night, I think, for Turner Gill to come back to this stadium and all these fans and the welcome that he's had. And it's been a great welcome by the fans, and we'll have more on that this evening. So welcome him back, and I think it's going to be a fun football game.
Bashir's waiting for it on the goal line. The kickoff coming from Kanalik. Here comes Bashir's. And Bashir's with a nice return. Had one man to beat, and he is tackled at the 45-yard line. Kanalik got a piece of him, the kicker, or he was gone to the end zone.
Well, DJ Bashir's has given him big play capability as a kick returner. There's no doubt about that. And what he's done this season, he's averaged pretty good job there on kick returns. He's got 667 yards coming in here, and he just runs through some tackles there and sets the Jayhawks up with good field position for their first possession at the 45-yard line.
Buddy Kanalik saved the day for the Huskers, and a huge play to start things off for KU. That'll settle Turner Gill in. Now Quinn Meekum, he's making his third straight start. They thought they were going to redshirt this junior college player, but instead he was forced into action with injuries to Webb and Pick. No room to run inside at all. As the black shirts come up big, Jared Crick makes the stop. And a Levante David, who is the leading tackler of this team, also in there. David with 96 total tackles. Play action. Meekin's going to run with it, and he tucks the ball and goes to the 50-yard line. Let's check out the Jayhawks offensively, brought to you by Ticket Express. And up front, Sal Capra is the captain of the offensive line, and he is the guy that's really making all the play calls. The go-to guys, Patterson and Bashir's, those are the real playmakers for them on offense, along with Jonathan Wilson. Third and 6. Meekum back to throw, and wide open on the flat is Angus Quigley, the running back, and someone left him uncovered.
Well, what you're seeing from Quinn Meekum to start this football game is a very accurate quarterback. And Dave, last week, he completed his last 17 passes in a row. He was 12 for 12 in the fourth quarter and picking up right here where he left off. So Quinn Meekum now in his third start for Kansas, showing that they can move the football through the air with him throwing the ball.
Good numbers for Meekum, 73%. And now coming out of the Wildcat. On the keeper there, Sims takes it down to the 36-yard line. Let's check out the Huskers defensively. Again, brought to you by Ticket Express. And up front, Alan Crick, Steinkuhler, and Meredith. They need to put more pressure on the quarterbacks. Not nearly as many sacks as they had a year ago. Linebackers, David, we've already talked about him with almost 100 tackles. Will Compton back after missing the first 4 games with injury. Secondary, a bit of a change as Cassidy gets a start ahead of Ricky Tenars. Cassidy, of course, last week with an interception and a return for a touchdown. Here, good defensive play. No room to run for Bashir's as Denard comes up, or Dennard, excuse me. Dennard comes up from his cornerback position to make the play.
Well, you're going to see the speed of the Nebraska defense here and trying to get to the outside and just can't get there because this Nebraska team will string it out. And good to see Dennard back in the lineup. He missed last week, and he's been out a couple of weeks with a sore ankle, so good to have him back there for the Huskers. And he and Prince Amukamara, probably two of the best cornerback tandem in the country.
Now, when Dennard and Amukamara are out there together, I tell you, I don't know who is better than that. Sims Well, they tried a little shovel pass, and it went almost nowhere because Levante David was there.
A good job here by the defense of not allowing a big play to happen. This is a shovel pass right in the middle there and trying to get things going. But obviously, James Sims tackled right there at the point of attack. I think it was Levante David coming in and making a nice play.
David approaching 100 tackles. He's got a good chance to set an all-time tackle mark here at Nebraska.
Well, Levante David, I like what he's accomplished this year. He's got a number of games where he's had multiple tackles, averaging over 11 tackles per ball game. So he's one of the leaders, not only in the Big 12, but also in the nation, getting to the football.
Timeout taken by the Jayhawks. It looked like they were going to go for it on fourth down, and you wonder if maybe they were just trying to draw the Huskers offside.
Well, I think this is a situation where you got to make the right decision for your team, okay? Are you coming in here and you're going to make a statement early in this game with your first drive, putting points on the board? I'm sure that's what Turner Gill would like to accomplish. Now, can they make the long field goal from here? It would be about a 52, 53-yard field goal attempt if they were to go for it. Or are they going to try to go for it and get that first down? It's going to be tough to go against this Nebraska defense. They have played pretty good defense, you know, off and on throughout the season. And there are a bunch of guys up front that I know would probably be looking to take care of this fourth and six situation, get off the field.
Everybody here in Nebraska saying, man, are we glad this game wasn't played last night?
Yes.
3 inches of snow and the conditions were awful. Now 40 degrees, the winds have calmed down. Actually a perfect night to play football.
It's an absolute perfect day or evening to play football. I'd like to be out there hitting it myself. It's one of those games and times, you know, as athletes, when it's a little bit cooler, a little bit crisper in the air, you don't get as tired as quick because that air is dense, it's thick, you can breathe well, and now these guys are going to have a fun time this evening.
You think now after Kansas has had time to think this over, they may just go ahead and pooch punt it down and try to pin Nebraska down deep in their own end.
Yeah, but I think I see the offense still out there together in the huddle out there. And you take a look at the series here with the Huskers, and you know, this is one of the all-time great series, and it's been going together for a long time.
Well, it has. In fact, this is the 105th consecutive meeting between these two schools. That's the longest consecutive streak in the nation. Of course, it'll all come to an end after this year when Nebraska moves to the Big Ten.
Now, these are the kind of decisions that Turner Gill learned about as a Nebraska assistant coach. What do you do in these situations? And he makes that decision here on the field. First critical decision for him in his ball game, and he looks like his team's poised to go for it here on fourth down.
The Jayhawks are 9-for-18 this year on fourth down.
You know, surprisingly, the crowd is roaring loud, but they're not overly impressive here early on.
And Meekum will be sacked. Not only do they not get the first down, they lose yardage as DeJohn Gomes comes in to make the play and the sack for the Huskers, and Meekum goes down. Nebraska will take over on downs at their own 41.
Well, DeJohn Gomes, he's their number two tackler on this football team, and they'll bring him on pressure as well. They feel like he can get home, and he just times it around the edge. Good job by Gomes, and not enough blockers there. The quarterback needs to get rid of that football. Meekum did not have an open receiver, just had to eat this one, and Gomes makes a nice play for the defense, sets up the offense with good field position.
So Taylor Martinez comes out to guide the offense here, working from the shotgun. Martinez to pass on first down. His pass is complete. Brandon Kinney with the catch. He's near midfield. He is stopped at the 49-yard line by Olaiten Ogontodu. So Taylor Martinez, his numbers are really staggering.
Yeah, 112 rushes there, over 800 yards rushing, the 12 touchdowns, and he's passed the ball well. Only 3 interceptions on the year, so he's actually taking care of it. He has fumbled a little bit in the backfield. As we take a look at the offensive line, Caputo does a nice job at center up there anchoring this group, and this is an offensive performance I think has been pretty good. And all these guys, Halu, we've talked about him and his running capability. Those are the guys I think are probably going to make an impact, especially with Taylor Martinez and Roy Halu. We'll see how well that tandem works tonight.
Starting lineups brought to you by Ticket Express. So third and short now facing the Huskers. As they have the ball right at midfield, they need to get just past the 49 of KU for the first down. From the I formation. Halu dotting that eye. And the give is to Halu. Stopped at the line. He does not have the first down. Stopped by Jake Laptad.
Jake Laptad, the senior defensive end, takes an inside charge there. If that's him actually on the tackle, and does a nice job of stopping Halu before he gets the first down. So it's a fourth down, and looks like Bo Pelini doesn't hesitate. He sends his punt team out there here just across the bit, right at midfield.
How about that? Who would have thought that they would be stuffed like that? Damon Patterson waiting for it at his own 10-yard line. Henry does all the kicking chores except for kickoffs. It's the only thing he doesn't do. He punts and is one of the most special place kickers in the country. Fair catch by Patterson, so Kansas will take over on offense from their own 13-yard line. We've got a timeout. First quarter action, no score from Memorial Stadium. Kansas and Nebraska, no score. We've played about 5 minutes of this game. Nebraska went three and out. Kansas started the game with an excellent kickoff return of 45 yards and moved it inside of Nebraska territory. Went for it on fourth down, were unsuccessful. And as I mentioned, Nebraska goes three and out. So Quinn Meekum brings the Jayhawks back on offense.
And he was impressive, I think, the last couple of weeks for this football team. 74% completions. He's got 401 yards in a couple of games and three touchdowns, and he's taking care of the football also. He kind of gives them that hope that they can throw the ball and gives them a threat when they're actually trying to do a run play action there. So I think Quinn Meekum has been a good fit here with a couple of quarterbacks that got injured this season.
Play action, throwing downfield and too long. His pass was intended for Patterson, and he overthrew him.
He's a junior college transfer from Snow Junior College, you know, entering Kansas this spring, and he was actually went through spring practice with him, so he did get some reps. He understands the offense now. Didn't get most of the reps early in the season because they had a couple other quarterbacks on their roster that they went with. Jordan Webb obviously got the start for most of the games, and Cale Pick. Those guys were in the heated battle to start and get the start. He was expecting to actually redshirt, but Quinn Meekum got called to duty.
Sims with the run. He gets it up to the 15-yard line. Dennard there on the stop along with Austin Cassidy.
Running the heart of this Nebraska defense right there with Jared Crick and Baker Steinkuhler. Inside running here I think is pretty tough against this defense, and those guys have played well. And Dennard, who was a pretty good tackler in his own right, coming up to make the stop there. And Jared Crick, he's been pretty impressive this year, albeit he's not there with the Ndamukong Suh. He's got Baker Steinkuhler as his run mate inside.
Third down and 9 yards to go. Meekum. Well, that was a busted play. He threw it at the feet of his intended receiver, Quigley, coming out on a screen. Crick and Meredith were really putting some pressure on.
Yeah, it looks like there may be a penalty, though, against the Nebraska defense. And we'll see if they sort this out. I'm not sure exactly what it's called here, but looked like something the umpire had thrown a flag.
Our referee is Carl Richens.
Well, the old defensive twist in there. Baker Steinkuhler has actually got called for the penalty here. We'll take a look at the left defensive tackle there. Watch as he grab and pull. He tackles the running back getting out on the screen. That's exactly what he called. So good call by the official, and going to give Kansas a first down here, moving the chains a little bit. But hey, it's a smart play by Steinkuhler, thinking he can make something happen, but you can't grab him. You got to shadow him.
Yeah, that was one where I'm sure he saw on film, uh-oh, they're going to try the screen pass, and he basically tried to tackle Quigley. So a first down for KU. And a running play here. Steinkuhler and Crick in on the stop.
I see already what Carl Pelini, the defense coordinator for Nebraska, is going to do. He's going to bring perimeter pressure against his Kansas offense. It seems like all night. Two or three plays now from the outside. Safeties have come to try to do some things in the backfield.
A little more up-tempo now for KU. So a quick snap it. Get a pass out to Patterson for short yardage. He's ruled out at the 29-yard line.
They've kind of changed things up and down, and Chuck Long was the offensive coordinator for Nebraska. Obviously got a lot of experience there and trying to give Carl Pelini's defense a lot of different looks and get some up-tempo, change the pace of the game to give them to their advantage.
Another third and long situation for KU, third and six. And down goes Meekum. All of a sudden, it's becoming a sack party. This time, it's Levante David.
Yeah, that's his fourth sack of the season. Levante David playing with speed. He's 6'1", 210 pounds, so kind of like a safety playing linebacker. He plays a weak side linebacker for them, and he just comes inside. And just not enough people to block up there. And the Jayhawks, a little bit of confusion perhaps. They blocked down, the guard blocked down, and did not pick him up. So don't know if that was a call there by Sal Capra where he missed it, but good job by Levante coming in using his speed to get that tackle.
Rojas to punt it away. Burkhead waiting for it. And it's a short punt. We'll take a Kansas bounce and be down at the 35-yard line. So a 41-yard punt with no return.
Well, nothing scathed right now for Turner Gill coming in here. You know, we talked about the reunion of him coming back to this stadium, and obviously it's a, you know, one of the things where he did some remarkable things for this football program over the time that he was, you know, a player here, and, you know, had a long stint as an assistant coach, and obviously, you know, he's one of the players that you can always think back of Nebraska, and one of the big ones here, and obviously he led this team to three consecutive Big Eight championships. His senior season, he was number four in the Heisman voting, and boy, he just was a spectacular athlete and fun to watch on the field.
Jim, you've been following Nebraska football for a long time, and you know how beloved Turner Gill is here in Lincoln.
He is one of the truly most beloved players of the last generation, Dave and Gary. There's no doubt about it. And largely because of his personality. He was an outstanding athlete surrounded by great athletes. Remember, he was here when Mike Rozier and Irving Fryer were here, the scoring explosion team of 1983. But Turner was the catalyst for that because he distributed the ball. He was the guy that ran the football team. He kept them together. And it was his steely resolve. And if you look at him today, he has not changed from the time when he played here. He used to drive Nebraska methodically down the field in that 1981 Missouri game that was 0-0 until the very last drive of the game, and Turner scored to give Nebraska the points it needed to win. And then in that Orange Bowl, lost to Miami of Florida. He is unflappable, or was unflappable as a player, and he has become that at Kansas. And I think that's one of the reasons he's such a great candidate to be a very successful head coach, because he's very consistent. Players and staff know what to expect out of him.
Thanks, Jim. Good perspective from the sidelines. Helu finds a hole across the right side and gets it up to the 40-yard line. Stop is made by Greg Brown, who is making his second start.
You see the numbers on Helu and what he's done this season. 7.3 yards per carry, and he and Taylor Martinez both over 7 yards. Martinez 7.9 yards averaging per carry. That's an amazing number for these guys this late in the season.
One of the most important games of the year. Helu really played well. 307 yards against the Missouri Tigers. That basically was for the Big 12 North, and certainly Nebraska still in the driver's seat, although Missouri won again today to keep the pressure on the Huskers.
Yeah, the Huskers still have to continue to win, but I think they've got a good shot to get what they need to get done with Taylor Martinez back at the quarterback position. A little bit unsettling when he was not able to play last week. They did put him in as a wide receiver. Kind of hurt his stats, though, on the year, because those numbers count against that game as he participated in the football game. And as you see, take a look at the two quarterbacks on the sideline, Cody Green and Zach Lee there, who called the signals from the sideline into Taylor Martinez.
Third and five, plenty of time, and this one way overthrown. Pass was intended on the outside for Kyler Reed, the tight end, and it was 10 feet over his head.
Well, Taylor Martinez threw that kind of awkwardly. He didn't set his feet, didn't come down and throw it. He just kind of launched it over there, and the ball just kind of took off on him. There's not a lot of wind here in this stadium tonight. I'm sure Jim could talk to us about that, but watch his footwork here. I don't think he really steps into this and sets his, throws it across his body, and very vertical there. You want to step into that and bend that front knee to have some velocity, and the ball just went up in the air.
So Henry to punt it away again, and this is a beauty. It'll force Patterson all the way back to the six, trying to break outside. And here come all the black shirts on special teams. They come at you in waves, and a return of only a couple of yards. It'll be Kansas starting deep in their own end at their own 7-yard line. Graham Stoddard was the one that finally brought Patterson down.
Good coverage there by Nebraska getting down. Patterson, who's got breakaway speed, he's got the ability to make a big play, but just nothing there because he got good coverage by the Huskers.
Surprisingly, Nebraska on offense has done very little so far in this game. A very slow start for the Huskers offensively. Their defense has played well, however.
It's an illegal formation, it looks like.
Bashir is lined up in the backfield. Bashir is with the ball. And he's able to get it up to the 16-yard line. Austin Cassidy makes the stop.
Yeah, what I circled was a couple of wide receivers on the line of scrimmage. You know, they were going to try to throw the ball, but obviously would have been an illegal formation. But it's an opportunity here to kind of get something in space there. And Bashir's, who's played some running back and some kick return for this football team. He's got some speed also, and they'd like to get the ball in his hands as well.
Now Sims back there with Meekum. Sims with the ball, nowhere to go. Boy, stopped immediately by David.
Not a big guy, Levante David, but he's around the football. Actually had to play some middle linebacker early this year and a little undersized for that. But on the weak side, I think that's the spot for him because he's able to come in and make some plays, and he steps right into the hole right there and does a nice job. I like the way he fits on the football. He's very aggressive, very active, and he can make plays sideline to sideline.
Junior college transfer David had 19 tackles against South Dakota State. He is what they call a playmaker,
yes,
Levante David.
With the
so,
third and short.
Third and two. They're going to throw on third down. Meekum had no one to throw it to, trying to run for it. He'll be stopped for a loss.
Guess who?
David again.
Well, he had some help there, and when Meekum tried to throw it down the field, and the coverage was too good in the secondary by Nebraska. That is one of the things that they really do well is they cover in the secondary, and Levante David, benefactor, because he's going to string his play out. Watch Quinn Meekum get the play action fake. He's trying to get out to the flat, but that's covered and taken away, and so the defense has a good job there coming up on him, and Levante David just cleans up on Quinn Meekum.
So Alonzo Rojas to punt from his own goal line. And again, it's Burkhead who is standing back at his own 42. Burkhead, a fair catch it at the 46-yard line. Well, Nebraska's had great field position. They haven't done much with it.
Can't complain about the field position they've had. They've just got to get going. And, you know, one of the things I think we're about to see here is, can Taylor Martinez explode off that leg? He's had a sore knee, got it banged up a couple weeks ago, but he's practiced all week. We have not seen him try to make a run here in this football game. He hasn't pulled the ball back. He's handed off, looking to see if he's ready to go. And it looks like he's favoring that leg at all. Just he's got to get in the heat of the battle here and feel comfortable about how he can perform, and he needs to get a couple of hits in there, possibly, Dave, to make sure that everything's okay.
Well, Gary, when we were talking to Sean Watson, the offensive coordinator, earlier this week, he said that the lateral movement, because of the ankle injury, is still a little bit iffy for Taylor Martinez.
Yeah, well, that's going to be an issue all season long. And I think when he can get him going vertical, that would be where he can turn on his speed. Now this is a guy that's kind of got 4.4 or sub 4.4 speed. And if he can use that to break down a defense, he certainly need to be able to do that. See him get the sideline, getting the call from the sideline, getting in the huddle, making that call. But right now, the Jayhawks are doing a nice job of stringing things out and not letting big plays happen against them.
That's for sure. They've only allowed 8 yards rushing so far. First 2 yards for Burkhead on his first carry. Martinez to throw it again, this time on target to Brandon Kinney. Kinney's got it, and that'll be close to a first down, but not quite there. He gets it down to the 46 of KU. Chris Harris makes the stop. Harris, by the way, he moves over to a safety position. He was their best cover guy at corner, but because they've had some problems in the secondary, they moved Harris over to the safety.
Yeah, well, depth is always a concern, and so when you got guys injured, if you got to move them around, that's what you need to have. You need to have guys step up, and Chris Harris, who's their number three tackler on the team, doing a pretty decent job.
Well, a third and two here for Martinez and company. Burkhead is in the backfield. Burkhead's got it. Trying to go laterally. He'll have the first down. And plenty more. He's hauled down at the 38-yard line by Barfield.
You know, that same kind of a play a couple of games this season, Roy Helu Jr. has broken through free on those and run for 50-yard touchdowns. To get the block on the outside, block inside, and there's a big hole, but they don't get all the Jayhawks accounted for. They do get the first down, but the Huskers have done a great job so far this season of accounting for everyone on the defense, getting a hat on a hat, and these running backs have run through their Burkhead, benefactor of that good blocking. You see his numbers on the season. He's a good compliment to Roy Helu Jr. and also to Taylor Martinez.
Coming off a career game against Iowa State, he had 20 carries for 129 yards and 2 touchdowns. Martinez had this one batted down at the line of scrimmage.
Tobin
O'Purim. Good play defensively by Tobin O'Purim, who was a former running back, in fact, the leading rusher for KU last year.
Well, there's a lot of coaches that when they come to a new team, or in this case, Turner Gill said, hey, we're going to find athletes that we can put on the defensive side of the ball, and that's what they've done with Tobin O'Purim. He was our leading rusher last year for Kansas, number 35. Watch him here as he gets his hands up and knocks the ball away as Taylor Martinez tries to throw the football. So good athletic play there. That's his second pass breakup of the year. He's done a pretty good job here for him as a defensive end.
So second and 10. Here comes some pressure from the outside, picked up well, and a pass on target to Mike McNeil.
And McNeil's done a nice job for this team getting down the field as a receiver. And, you know, he's got a 64-yard touchdown catch on the season, Mike McNeil has. And he's a bigger body outside, but he runs that seam route very well. This is what Tanner Martinez hits him on there, just inside the inside linebacker and in front of the safety and in the middle of the field. So good job of finding up a big target there in McNeil and gets a first down.
21-yard pass play. Now 3 of 6 Martinez in the air. And Burkhead runs into the line at the 15-yard line, a gain of a couple.
Yeah, a little wildcat formation there, getting Taylor Martinez out as a wide receiver. Burkhead takes the direct snap, and he and Roy Helu Jr. now in the backfield for the Huskers. And looks like that Helu's coming out. We're going to bring Brandon Kinney back into the football game for the Huskers offensively.
We're going to stop play here. Looks like some equipment is out on the field here at around the 27-yard line. They'll go out and pick that up.
One of those things where it's cold out. You get your hands in that basket there, kind of a hand warmer. One of the Nebraska players had that on there. Doesn't need it anymore. It's not that cold out. It really isn't.
Really,
the windows open here. It's great.
From the shotgun, Martinez gives it to Burkhead, and he is hit right at the line. The Jayhawks are really targeting the running game. And a big hit in the middle. Looked like Justin Springer was there, and then Steven Johnson.
Watch Steven Johnson come to the right side of the screen and meet Burkhead right there in the hole. Good job. That's where you form up, and 235-pound linebacker doing a good job of hitting there. He's a number two tackler on the team for the Jayhawks and steps up and makes a nice tackle on Burkhead.
Pretty good for a former walk-on, Johnson. So it's third down and 8 yards to go.
Officials coming in, going to reset the play clock here.
You know, the ball got kicked before they could snap it, so they'll reset that. Almost offsides, KU. Good pass on target again. All of a sudden, Martinez, he's hit 3 in a row. Another one to Kenny. This one for 11 yards and a touchdown.
Well, if you've ever had any questions about Taylor Martinez as a thrower and his accuracy, well, this one can kind of just put all that to rest, because what he throws here is a quick little slant. He's got to put this right on the receiver, Kenny, who's got a defender right with him. That's a perfect ball. Well thrown to him, and obviously easy to catch. When you can see that, we're coming right to you just like that. Good camera work, guys. Kenny does a nice job of pulling that ball in. That's the accuracy that they've seen in this young man. Hasn't been there all the time, but he certainly is capable of doing that. Just needs to work at being more consistent.
First and goal from the 5 again from the Wildcat, and walking into the end zone untouched, Rex Burkhead. Touchdown, Nebraska.
Wow, it's a sea of balloons we're seeing here, Dave. They're all coming out, and this is just a nice drive here. Good field position to start this, and Rex Burkhead at the Wildcat position back there at the quarterback spot takes the direct snap and takes it in, and well done by Kansas, finally taking advantage of the field position they've had tonight.
Henry with the point after. It's good. He's only missed one in his entire career. And Burkhead with his 6th rushing touchdown of the year. He had 2 last week. He starts Nebraska off on a good note as the Huskers lead 7-0. Bashirs grabs the kickoff, a short one that's at the 10. And look at Bashirs go again. Another impressive return for DJ Bashirs. Graham Stoddard yet again with the play to push him out of bounds. Look at Bashir's go.
Yeah, not the deepest kick, though, but Bashir's, you see the extra gear that he has. Get to the outside, make that step around the coverage there. It's an extra 5 or 6 yards, and he's got some big play capability. I've seen it earlier this season. He's done a nice job for him.
26 seconds to go in the first quarter, 7-0 lead on a Burkhead touchdown. Jim?
And if there was one criticism of the offense a week ago against Iowa State, fans, it was that maybe they could have run the Wildcat a little bit more. Burkhead was actually a high school quarterback through his junior year, so he's used to it, and maybe they could have run it a little bit more to be a little more, I guess, productive offensively against Iowa State. But I think you'll see a lot more Wildcat here tonight, guys, because they want to really go easy on Taylor's leg.
Not a bad move. Burkhead, by the way, the leading rusher for the Huskers in this game. He has 16 yards, and of course that 5-yard touchdown for Burkhead. And that'll be the end of the first quarter of play. So after a sluggish start offensively, Huskers looked good on that last drive. Martinez started to get on track, and then they handed it to Rex Burkhead, or actually took the snap and scored the touchdown for the Huskers. And after one quarter of play, Nebraska leads it at home at Memorial Stadium, 7-0 our score. Rather subdued crowd here at Memorial Stadium as Nebraska takes a 7-0 lead at the end of the first quarter on a Rex Burkhead 5-yard touchdown run. With Jim Rose and Gary Reasons, I'm Dave Armstrong, watching Turner Gill return to a place where he starred as a quarterback in the early 80s for Nebraska. Now coming back, as he told Jim Rose at the start of this game, it's just weird coming back here and being on the other sideline.
Yeah, and he talks about, you know, discipline and teaching his football team that. And I think that that's something that he'd like to continue to instill that in his football program. And so we had a chance to visit with Turner Gill about teaching discipline to his football team.
Well, second down and 8 for the Jayhawks as they begin the second quarter. And the handoff is to Bashir's. Bashir's runs around the outside and gets a couple of yards. Jared Crick ran all the way down the line to make the stop.
Well, Jared Crick has done that all season long for Nebraska, and you know, believe it or not, he's the third leading tackler on the team. Jared Crick is, and done a good job getting outside of the box there. He plays well in space. That's one of the things that I think about him as a defensive lineman that is impressive, is he makes plays on the sideline and as they going towards the sideline.
Third and 6 now for Quinn Meekum. Two receivers on each side of the ball. Meekum under pressure, steps up, drops the ball, falls down on it, and Crick falls down on him for another sack. Here's Nebraska that came into the game with only 20 sacks all year, and that's the third one of the night.
Yeah, pretty good job there in the secondary. Most importantly, they're covering well, and they're bringing them up front, get a little heat there, but Quinn Meekum really had nowhere to throw the ball because the secondary did a good job and just kind of all collapsed on him. He had nowhere to run.
So 3 and out for the Jayhawks. They'll punt it away again. Burkhead standing at his own 20-yard line. Alonzo Rojas, this one off the side of his foot. And it'll be downed at the 28-yard line. Turner Gill, of course, learned so much in his tenure here at Nebraska from Tom Osborne, and he talks about that being a big part of the discipline he's trying to bring the Jayhawks.
I didn't think it was really that big of a deal. I guess I some people may not ever make that statement to their team. I looked at it from a standpoint of Tom Osborne, John Wooden, as I read his books, and I obviously played with Coach Osborne and also coached with him. Those two people, I think the one common goal of why they were successful over a long period of time was discipline. They set parameters, and they stood by that. And I think that's why they were being able to be consistently winning year after year after year. They did not waver off of certain standards. And so I think, therefore, when this standard here is saying that there's no foul language or limit your foul language, again, I don't penalize them. I don't necessarily make them go do something. I just, purchase them.
Now, he's trying to bring some discipline to the Jayhawks. We asked him earlier this week. There are some fans of the Jayhawks are saying, well, that's all well and good, but what about wins? And Turner Gill is saying, no, that's all part of it. We're not only building character, but we're trying to build wins. Martinez has to run for it, and he gets it up to the 33-yard line where he's stopped by Steven Johnson.
Well, I think that what Turner Gill really is trying to bring to his football team is that discipline, consistency, and it's starting. He's getting there. As you see Tanner Martinez, the crowd continues to gets into it here for the first time. This is the first time he's taking it down and run the football. They kind of gasp because anything can happen when he runs the ball. They know there can be a huge play, and good job by the Jayhawks of converging on it.
5-yard gain. That makes it 3rd and 5 for the Huskers. Plenty of time to throw, and this one right on target, Kinney. We have a penalty flag down, And this one may come back, at least according to the guys in the secondary for KU.
Yeah, maybe pushing off by Kenny, getting a little separation. Something he probably doesn't need to do to get inside.
Currents, number 84, offense. 15-yard penalty, repeat third down.
Yeah, we're going to watch Brandon Kenny come off the line of scrimmage and see if he does push off on the defender. And he's going out, he has two hands into him. But you know what? That could be called two ways because you can't have contact behind 5 yards past line of scrimmage. And the cornerback certainly was there. And Rick Brown in coverage. He gets pushed away by Brandon Kenny, but it goes against Nebraska.
It's a huge penalty. Instead of being across midfield, it's backed all the way up to the 17-yard line.
Yeah, third and very, very long here. You want to be safe here, and I'm not sure that Sean Watson's going to call anything pretty tricky here with Taylor Martinez, and maybe okay to just punt this ball away if you can't get it here on third down.
And a whistle and a stoppage of play. I think the play clock expired.
That was a quick play clock if it was.
Prior to the snap, ball start, number 58, offense, 5 yard penalty, still third down.
That's the center.
They must have moved the ball a little bit or something. Maybe he thought the snap count was one thing, and I didn't see it though. So Bo Pelini obviously asking the side judge there, actually, what's going on?
Bo Pelini telling us that those three inside guys, Caputo, Williams, and Henry, are the heart and soul of their offensive line. Back them up five more, third and 25. Pass across the middle, caught!
Wow.
What a catch by Niles Paul!
I tell you, Phillips Grozier's right there in coverage, and I'm surprised that Niles Paul catches his ball. It's a little bit high, but he goes up the highest point. Watch him come inside here. Paul, one of the leading receivers in all time here at the University of Nebraska, does a great job of going up, grabbing that ball, and more importantly for the Huskers, getting a first down. And Grozier didn't make huge contact on him, possibly could have knocked that ball loose.
And a first down, a big first down conversion for the Huskers. Hello. Waited a little bit for the blocks in front of him, and he is downed at the 40-yard line. Chris Harris comes up from his safety position.
Well, the defense here does a nice job stringing out, and see them all trying to run Halu, trying to get up in the blocks, and they just don't get on the blocks. And Halu needs to cut that inside of that, trying to set up his so the offensive players can get on their blocks. He just took that outside too far.
Three rushes today for Halu, only 6 yards for him. He hasn't been able to get on track yet. And it's second down and 8 yards to go. Burkhead from the Wildcat again. And the handoff. Go outside with the ball. Gain of about 3 yards here as Halu able to get it up to the 43.
Well, third manageable here. Third and four, it looks like, for Taylor Martinez. And changing personnel here. Going to a different group here offensively for Nebraska. Taking all the way down the play clock. And since
play clock's down to 9,
time out,
they're going to have to. They're not even break the huddle. Play clock is down to 4, and they will call a timeout. Bo Pelini wondering what happened there. So a little breakdown, and we'll take a break with them. It's 7-0 Nebraska.
.10 to go in the first half. Nebraska out in front here at Memorial Stadium in the longest continuous series in college football over Kansas. Niles Paul just got a terrific ovation from the fans here. It's been quite a time for Niles lately. He's really not met his own expectations, much less those of the fans who saw him as the next great Omaha, Nebraska football player to join the ranks of Johnny Rogers and his uncle Amon Green and Eric Crouch. No doubt this is a guy who they really have heaped great expectations on, fellas, and he hopes to meet them at the end of the year.
Thanks a lot, Jim. As Paul perhaps could be a target here on third and 5 yards to go for Taylor Martinez and the Huskers. Paul, of course, a lot of Husker fans will look at that game against Texas where he had 4 drops in that game. No drops here today. He is the go-to guy, and they get another first down. You know, I think that says a lot about Niles Paul and his character, too, to be able to bounce back from a game like that and come back in and play so well.
Well, the following week, I remember that game well. He actually had another long touchdown pass thrown to him. He also dropped another one, though, but he came back into it. So Niles Paul has been up and down, and those are his numbers on the season so far. So, you know, he can make big plays here for this team. He's a good complement to the run game that Nebraska has.
Another first down for KU. Alou comes into the picture. Martinez on the keeper, doesn't have that outside burst, and you wonder about that lateral movement, able to only gain one as Chris Harris comes up.
I'm not sure that there was a Kansas player, may have been in the neutral zone and just standing up there. I'm not sure they were ready to go, and ball was snapped, and I'm not sure if there was a, didn't see a flag thrown on that, but it looked like one of the defensive linemen were standing right. Look, is he offsides? Is he at the line of scrimmage right here? A little unique to see that happen.
And Halu tries to go to the outside and goes nowhere. Justin Springer, the middle linebacker there. Running's been tough for Halu today. He's got only 11 yards on the ground. He's become a real target for the Jayhawk defense.
Well, Carl Torbush, the defensive coordinator, has really worked with these guys to keep and play with leverage and fit on blocks, and doing a pretty decent job here against this spread attack. The zone read, so to speak, from Nebraska, and keeping things in front of them, making tackles, and so far doing a good job of tackling tonight, the Jayhawks are.
34 yards on the ground so far for the Huskers. Good breakup here on the outside. What a nice defensive play by Kansas as Tyler Patman makes a great play defensively for KU.
Yeah, Tyler Patman jumps in as the nickelback for him there on those situations. So he's got the inside receiver, does a nice job. It's a shorter route and knocks that ball away and gets him off the field.
So Henry back to punt it away. Patterson waiting for it at his own 10-yard line. High snap. Kick is on its way. High, booming kick. Boy, look at that hang time, and the bounce will take it into the end zone. And Kansas will start at their own 20-yard line. 49-yard punt for Henry.
Yeah, Henry's one of those guys that's got a terrific career going on with Nebraska as a punter. He does a good job getting inside the 20 place in the football. But really, as a place kicker, PATs and field goals, he's going to be the all-time leader in NCAA history in several categories when his career ends, Dave.
And a lot of those have to do with accuracy.
Yes, it is, it does. And he is one of the most accurate kickers I've ever seen. And he and Dan Bailey this year for Oklahoma State, another kicker. Both of them have had terrific years, and it's kind of back and forth. Those two guys together this year in the Big 12 as kickers, I think that's two of the best in the country.
You played in the NFL. Do you ever see the possibility, most teams, in fact, I don't know of any team that has a place kicker and a punter that's the same guy. Do you see it happening?
There are some that have done it, but not in recent memory that I can remember. But obviously, he can certainly be a benefit to a team where he can do dual jobs. And guess what? That opens up another roster spot for someone up for perhaps on an NFL roster. And, you know, he might ask for a little more cash because of that, too. So works well in his favor.
Well, it's interesting. Alex Henry is one of the all-time greats and should be the all-time leading scorer in Nebraska history when he's done. Jim?
And what a bargain, too, Dave. He was a walk-on. He came to Nebraska on academic scholarship. He was primarily a soccer player at Burke High School in Omaha, went to Catlin Magnet Center, Beveridge Junior High, and Burke High School. He was playfully referred to as sort of Napoleon because he bears a little bit of a resemblance to Napoleon Dynamite. But he is dynamite with that toe. He's always had great range, but it's that mental toughness that'll make him one of the greats. And as a walk-on, how about that?
How about that? Quinn Meekum, he'll not be a walk-on in the NFL. He'll be a draft choice, and he won't be Mr. Irrelevant. Crowd revving it up now. Meekum looking for a screen pass, nowhere to go. Now room to run. And Meekum goes outside and will go out of bounds after a gain of 16 up to the 36-yard line.
He's 6'2", 205 pounds, got a little bit of ability, as you see there, getting outside. And they're only rushing three here in Nebraska. He's just trying to contain him. And coming around the horn there is Jared Crick, but he just goes a little bit too wide. And Meekum steps up inside and then scoots around the edge, gets around Gomes.
And make it a 15-yard gain. They rule him out at the 35. receivers. Two of them to the low side, one to the high side. Looking to the high side, nothing there. And so Meekum will come back. He was actually looking on the outside for McDougald, but he was well covered.
Dave, you said the one thing there, nothing there. There really wasn't. Yeah. There, everyone was covered very well by Nebraska in the secondary. Nobody was open. Hit three players out in the route, and there were just red shirts by him. You see on the outside there, there's nowhere to throw that football, obviously. And Alfonso Dinner doing a nice job at the top of the field.
Give us to Sims. He's hit after a short game. Levante David again.
Levante's got about a half a dozen tackles already. I don't have the stats, but seems like he's around the football all the time. And just want from an active linebacker.
Talking about David earlier this week here in Nebraska, and saying when they brought him in to recruit him, they wanted to make sure, since he was a junior college transfer, that he really understood schemes and stuff. They asked him all kinds of questions. He answered all of them correctly, and they said, boy, this kid's really special. He really understands the game. Very bright out there. Third and long. Meekum, his pass batted down at the line of scrimmage. Looked like David got a hand on that one.
Well, this is a blitz here from the outside by Kansas. They're trying to take a quick read away here and make the quarterback throw it quickly. Trying to bring, excuse me, from Nebraska, they're bringing pressure from the top of the screen. You see from the left side, you'll see a defender come in, and David does get his hand on the ball. And there's also pressure from that from a cornerback. So looks like you see the pressure at the top of the screen here, and then the blitz inside. So good job by the Nebraska defense getting off the field again.
Fourth punt for Rojas. High punt this time, fair catch called for, and then Burkhead just let it go. And it'll be down by Kansas at the 23-yard line. A defensive battle between the Huskers and the Jayhawks. We're in the second quarter with Nebraska leading at 7-0. Sold out yet again here at Nebraska. They've been sold out every game since 1962. The Huskers lead at 7-0 coming up at the half. And we've got 6 minutes and 45 seconds till we get to that point. Jim Rose will sit down with Nebraska women's basketball coach Connie Yorey. The men started their play last night. We'll show you some highlights from that game, an 8-point victory for the Huskers, and highlights and stats from this game. So Nebraska will start at their own 25-yard line is where they actually downed it. I think the ball hit one of the KU defenders when it bounced, and so they'll mark it at the 25. So here comes Taylor Martinez. He is backed by Roy Helou in the backfield. And they'll move both Cotton and Reed to the right side. And with those two guys blocking, Helou has room to run. Chris Harris had to make the stop in the secondary, but a gain of 9.
They cleaned out some of the players that are there, and then Helou does the rest. He just jumps right over. I like it sometimes when the players go airborne. Watch this. You see the block there, and he just has to get over the. It's actually his blocker out the front. Gets outside of Ricky Henry there, who's about blocking number 74, and has to jump over.
It's interesting, in visiting with Carl Torbush, who is the defensive coordinator for Kansas earlier this week, he said, with great respect, that offensive line for Nebraska, they are nasty. This will be a first down for the Huskers. Hey, look at how they move that pile. Yeah. Helou will get it up to the 38.
I actually asked Carl, I said, you know, what do you think about this offensive line? Kind of, they do a good job of getting on blocks and making this run game going. He's, you know, he was very, very, you know, kind of what he said about the offensive line. Said they're a great group of guys and they really do play together, and they got a little mean streak in them. That's mm-hmm. what I think he was trying to say, that they're going to be physical and going to bring their game all the time.
Fresh set of downs for the Huskers. Clock winding down, under 6 minutes to go. Martinez fires a strike on the outside to Kenny, and he is hit down out of bounds, and he gets it up to the 47-yard line. Ogun Todu with the stop there.
With the play action fake here, you see you have to take care of the run responsibility inside, so can't get extension out there, get up close to the receiver. So it's a quick little fake inside and toss it out there, and Kenny does a nice job getting a few yards after the catch, and it's explosive 9 yards very quickly.
Four catches for Kenny now for 34 yards today. Second and short. On the Wildcat again. Burkhead will keep it himself, go across midfield, and he'll have a first down.
Well, Kansas, one of the teams in the nation, not doing a great job against the run. 203 yards allowed, and today 48 yards. They've done a pretty good job of holding in there, but overall, this is something that they'd like to slow down a little bit. That's 107th in the nation, 203 yards per ball game.
Your standards are tough, Gary. 48, I'm saying that's really good.
Well,
that's just pretty good.
It's pretty good. Well, you might multiply those times four, and you're looking at a couple hundred yards on the day for Nebraska. That's well below their norm.
Yeah, it is, because they averaged 288 yards. Yeah. That one batted down by Opurum. Really adapted to defense very well. They moved him around. They started him as a linebacker,
yeah.
And now they moved him to the defensive end spot.
Well, you know, you got an athlete, and you know, he just gets in the good vision there. Good job getting his hands up and in the way of Taylor Martinez. Second knockdown, pass break up the day.
He'll self take note. That was a nice shot block.
You got to time those jumps.
So second and 10 from midfield. Martinez looking outside. Pass is on target, caught by Paul. He straight arms his way, stays in bounds, and is out at the 43 where Isaiah Barfield and he tangled up.
Well, Isaiah Barfield, I think, took the worst of this one.
Yeah.
Watch Paul on the outside. He catches and turns up. Barfield should just have a nice, easy tackle, but guess what? Now, you're going the other way. Paul showing he's got a little strength in that stiff arm.
I remember when we were here in September, Sean Watson said that Paul has a linebacker's mentality.
Showed it there.
Third down and 4 yards to go. Martinez will throw across the middle. There's Paul with room to run. Paul is tripped up but falls forward to the 31. Barfield was the man to trip him up.
Nice crossing route there from the outside, coming across shallow and throw it to a speedy Paul across the middle, and no one's going to catch him and no one's covering him there. So good job of play calling here by Sean Watson to get something, get that first down, and then let your receivers run after catch. And Paul does a nice job here.
106 yards through the air now for Martinez. He's 9 of 15 on the day. And four catches today for Paul. McNeil has the other catch. Paul and Kinney with four each. Big run here by Burkhead.
Good athlete, Burkhead. You see his balance, you see his ability to bounce off the tacklers and make extra yardage, and almost keeps his balance here. This might have been a touchdown if he'd get a little bit more. Watch the spin here after the contact. He just keeps going and keeps those legs just like a motor, just churning.
So a run down to the 20-yard line, still plenty of time remaining. I wonder if they run the same play they did to start this drive. They do. They brought the two tight ends over. Helu gets free, and he's into the end zone for the touchdown. Wow.
Well, kind of a slow start for Nebraska early in this ball game, but they've certainly turned it on here of late. Martinez throwing the ball well, and then the runners here, they're doing a good job. Burkhead, and then Helu actually gets the payoff, and a nice job here. Watch the elusiveness of Helu Jr. as he scats inside, then back bounces back to the outside, playing off the block there, and then the speed. It's not two-hand touch. You got to tackle him, Chris Harris. You can't let him run through there. It's not a good job by your free safety coming over making a play.
Henry with a point after. That's automatic. And a nine-play, 75-yard drive for the Huskers. Helu scores from 20 yards out. That was the exact same play, really, how they started the drive way back in their own end, and they came back with it from the 20.
Yeah, it's a good job of Nebraska just converting on situations, and I think they've made some offensive adjustments here with Sean Watson getting the play call into to Taylor Martinez, and he's operating a little bit better. He's had a couple of poor throws, I think, but overall, he's gotten the ball to his receivers, and obviously on the outside, Niles Paul's catching the ball well and making some yards. Brandon Kinney also. So I think the passing game and the run game seem to be both pretty well balanced here. You know, we talk a lot about this ball game with Kansas, you know, and Nebraska coming to an end. You know, this is the 105th consecutive time between these two football teams, and it's obviously one of those that is going to come to an end, and that's a serious Jayhawk history that we have that. And you know, we saw Turner Gill play well. There's some other guys that have played, and You know, one of the greatest of all time at the play for the University of Kansas is obviously, well, good old Gale Sayers here. And he takes this run long, and this is a run against the Huskers from a long time back. And Gale Sayers, obviously a great career at Kansas and one of the best ambassadors, still works with the program and does fundraising for them and works in the community. And one of their beloved sons, much like Turner Gill, to Nebraska.
Absolutely. Gale Sayers, a legendary figure at Kansas with one of his runs for the Jayhawks. 99-yard run.
Pretty good job, huh?
For a touchdown. Turner Gill's team now has to come from behind again. Do they have another comeback in them? Last week, of course, that comeback against the Colorado Buffaloes. In that game, they were down 45-17. Looked like they were going nowhere fast. Even Chuck Long the next day said, the offensive coordinator, he goes, we kind of woke up the next day going, what happened?
Exactly.
All of a sudden, they flipped on a switch and 35 straight points by KU.
Well, the Jayhawks, I think, have done a decent job of holding the point production down here from Nebraska. I don't think they've solved the mystery of how to slow this offense completely down. Only 14 points scored here in the first half with 3 minutes left to go. So I would think that Carl Torbush is probably pleased with his defensive job so far. The offense from Kansas needs to get on track.
Kanalik to Bashirs, 3 yards deep. Bashirs this time will not get to the 20. He's had two big returns in this game, but that time stopped shy of the 20-yard line.
That's just good coverage by Nebraska, getting down the field and making a play inside the 20-yard line. That's what you'd like to have happen. And you know, 3 minutes here. I don't think you're going to be real cute if you're Kansas. You don't want to have any kind of mistakes. Wouldn't make them. Coming back, you take a look at the Shears here on this return. You can see the coverage there by Nebraska. A pretty good hit, too.
Kind of can't blame for Shears for trying to bring it out. He's had two big runs. In hindsight, maybe should have taken it just at the 20. The run here by Quigley, and he'll gain a couple. Two timeouts remaining for each team.
Yeah, I think that Nebraska may be trying to utilize their timeouts. If they stop them here, I would be surprised if Kansas accelerates their pace. They need to perhaps get off the field here. They have to punt. They don't leave a whole lot of time for Tedder Martinez to operate with the offense.
Bashirs in the backfield. That's Beery in motion. Bashirs, he's got the handoff, trying to bust outside. And a short gain again. Gomes came up from his safety spot to help on the stop. Also there was Amuka Mara.
An unbalanced formation by Kansas, bringing the strong side all the way over here. And Bashir is supposed to go back door, but he doesn't go there. He goes to the front side where all the people are. So that's a mistake by Bashir's not going to where that play was called.
So a timeout taken here. 2:19 remaining. Nebraska's the one that takes the timeout.
Yeah, they
want to get the ball back again.
No doubt about it. You know, if they feel like they can stop them here on third down, they've been using another timeout and perhaps get the ball back with over 2 minutes to go in this half. And that's plenty of time for them to make some explosive plays. We've seen them score from out.
All they need is about 8 seconds.
Yeah, you know, just however long it takes to run down there. It seems like they're making a huge play after huge play this season. They strike from out. We saw a little graphic earlier in this ball game about how explosive they are.
Jim?
This has been a really good half for the Blackshirts, fellas. The statistics tell the story. They've given up so few yards. They've gotten 4 sacks. They want to start playing consistently better. No longer are they going to allow the excuses that they've had the last few weeks. We'll talk more about that in the second half.
Well, they've only allowed 24 yards on the ground, 39 yards overall in this game. That's it. 39 yards total offense for KU, and it'll be 3 and out here as Beery can't make the grab that would have been plenty for the first down, but it'll be 3 and out.
And they helped Nebraska, didn't have to use a timeout,
right,
by throwing it incomplete, so the clock stops, and now you got the punt team on the field.
Been a tough go for Meekum. Meekum just 3 for 7 through the air.
Rojas, not a good punt. Has a short punt, so Nebraska's going to get decent field position. Still bouncing around there. It's going to finish up around the 35, 30, maybe the 35-yard line.
That came close to Antonio Bell. He was able to not let the ball touch him. That would have been a disaster for Nebraska. Instead, they start at their own 35-yard line. Plenty of time remaining, 2 minutes remaining, and they still have one timeout.
Yeah, they can do just what they've been doing here. And take a look here as the ball's bouncing around there. Almost hits a Nebraska player, gets over it and jumps over it. You had to get out of the way.
A lot of times those special teams guys, they'll try to push you into the ball.
You think?
Yeah.
He wouldn't do that.
On the end around, Alou comes from the outside and spins back inside and brings it up to the 38-yard line, a gain of three.
And hurry up offense here, get on the field and get set up. Plenty of time still to work with.
On play action, Martinez throwing into double coverage, and it was almost picked off. Pass was intended for Kyler Reed, and Ogontodu almost had an interception.
You said double coverage. Well, there's actually three guys out there, Dave, and you got the cornerback up front. You got an expanded linebacker who comes to the outside, and then you got the safety over the top. So Taylor Martinez trying to throw this in there where he doesn't have a reason to throw it in there. Almost had one go the other way from Kansas.
So third and seven for Martinez. Clock stops with 1:30 remaining until halftime. Martinez looks like he's got room to run. And is hauled down shy of the first down marker. What a good play on the outside from Anthony Davis.
Good job of coming up tackling the speedy quarterback. But you know, Dave, I don't think that Taylor Martinez has the confidence in his leg and his high ankle sprain to be able to run as well as he has, because the old Taylor Martinez that I've seen earlier in the season, he would cut the ball right at the middle of the field and just take it north and south, and he's trying to run out of bounds, not even well short of the first down.
So it's fourth down. They will not go for the first down. They'll send their punting unit out, and Kansas took a timeout, so they'll have one timeout remaining and 1:04 on the clock.
It looks like Turner Gill says, hey, coach, you know, you can take a timeout. I can take one. I'm going to get the ball back now. Put my team back out there with a chance to make something happen. You never know what happens if you get something on a punt can go your way.
Let's check out some scores from earlier today. We told you about Missouri beating Kansas State, 38-28 the final, and a little surprising that it was that high scoring. Colorado bounces back after their tough loss to Kansas, and they wallop Iowa State 34-14, even though their coach was fired midweek. Oklahoma looked impressive today against Texas Tech.
Yeah, Oklahoma's a team obviously in the Big 12 South, and still looming ahead is Oklahoma State. I think that clash is going to have a big say-so on who wins the Big 12 South. Nebraska certainly in the driver's seat here in the Big 12 North by defeating Missouri, and well, they've taken a one-game lead here in this in the North Division.
One of the biggest surprises of the year in the Big 12, Texas, and the struggles that they have had. They play Oklahoma State tonight.
Yeah, they're playing tonight, so that's going to be a story there. And obviously you take a look here at the conference record for Nebraska, and I did mention the defeat they had over Missouri, so they're certainly where they want to be.
Patterson is waiting for it, and now he moves up to the 30-yard line, trying to draw him offside, and Kansas stood their ground. So they'll take the delay a game, trying to sneak a first down in there.
Thank you.
Well, I'm not sure that was going to be a first down, or would have worked, but
no, it would have been. It would have been four.
Yeah, it would have been short.
It would have been
a little over.
It would have been over. It. They needed four. Would have been five. Fair catch, and then he just lets it go. Actually take a Kansas bounce and come back to the 14-yard line. But another impressive punt for Alex Henry. He is a weapon on special teams. This punt of 49 yards.
And he also does directional punting. What I mean by that is he can kick it right or left, and you can adjust your coverage that way as far as covering the kick. And the time he did a directional to the left and did a nice job.
Safe to say his soccer career is over. So under a minute to go for Quinn Meekum. 3 for 7 Meekum through the air, only 15 yards. Only 45 yards of total offense for KU in the first half. As Jim said, the Blackshirts have done an amazing job. And the give here is to Quigley, and he just runs into a wall of Meredith and Steinkuhler.
Yeah, when they get that poor field position after the punt to the 15-yard line, I think this is the right call by Turner Gill to say, hey, let's just go ahead and hand the ball off and get out of here, and let's not do anything foolish that could perhaps turn the ball back over to Nebraska.
Each team with a timeout, neither will choose to use it here. They're just going to let the play clock and the game clock run out to the half. Play clock now is showing 14. I don't think Nebraska would take a timeout, so you could almost take a knee here if you're Meeker.
Yeah, I think you could.
And again, stuffed for a loss this time. Jared Crick makes the stop, and Angus Quigley, and that'll do it. The first half comes to a close, and again, I think the dominant figures in that first half, you just have to give it to the black shirts.
Defense did a nice job shutting down Quinn Meekum, not able to get anything going with his offense, throwing the football and running the ball. The defense did a great job inside the running attack. Steinkuhler and Jared Crick held up very well inside.
Meekum really didn't have time to throw the ball. A lot of pressure on him in that first half.
Yeah, Carl Plenty brought some perimeter pressure, so that worked for him tonight.
Let's go down to Jim Rose.
Bo, you got to be awfully happy with the way the black shirts played in the first half.
Yeah, we played well defensively. We got to be more efficient on offense. And, you know, gave a couple plays up on kickoff. We gave up some returns where guys missed tackles. So we got to clean up our football and play a better second half.
From the running attack, that last drive that scored the second touchdown, up until then a little inconsistent. What happened on that last drive that was so much better?
Well, we executed. Our tempo picked up. And when our tempo's better, we play better. And we started off. I didn't like our tempo to start. We just got to fix that aspect of it.
Evaluate Taylor's half. Is he still hobbling a little bit?
No, he's fine.
Okay, that's both. Thanks, Coach. At the half, 14-0 Nebraska, fellas.
Thanks a lot, Jim. 14-0, and he wants his offense to do a better job. Can't get much better defensively than the Nebraska Cornhuskers. Welcome back to Memorial Stadium in Lincoln. Fans settling back into their seats. Players back out onto the field getting warmed up, ready to start the second half of play with Nebraska leading it 14-0. Gary, again, it was the black shirts that were really the story for the Huskers in that first half.
Yeah, they heated things up early on. Quinn Meekum, a little pressure on the outside. Dejon Gomes gets the first sack of the evening, and it didn't stop there because they continued to put pressure. Levante David, this is the first of two sacks that he's had this evening. The speedy linebacker showing his ability to get to the quarterback on consecutive plays here. So good job by the black shirt defense, and that's exactly what they needed here to come in, set the tone against a team that played very well last weekend. Just in the fourth quarter, they've taken them squarely out of the ballgame.
David was six total tackles in the first half, including two sacks, so he's over 100 tackles on the year. So how will the Kansas Jayhawks make a comeback in the second half? With more on that, Turner Gill is standing by with our Jim Rose.
Halftime, Coach, overall you got to be pleased with the way you played defensive football against their rush. What do you need to do in the second half?
Offense just got to play well. Right? Get further their defense. We know they had a good, very good defensive team, but we got to play better than that and help our defense. Our defense has held in pretty well. Special team is doing okay. We got to make some plays. We got to make some plays in every phase to win this game.
Brashears has looked really good returning kicks.
Well, he's a big play guy for it. He has good speed, good strength, and again, we're trying to get the ball to him where he can make him plays for us.
Is Nebraska's secondary as good as advertised?
Oh, very good. Very good. But we still got to make plays.
Good luck in the second half, Turner.
I got the theme of that, Gary. It's make plays.
Yeah, they got to make plays. You know, one of the things I think that really can help them is get a turnover or two in this ball game. Make something happen. Haven't seen any balls on the ground, any balls really that Kansas has really had a chance to get in their hands. And when they get those opportunities, they need to do so.
Marlowe and Niles Paul back deep for the Huskers. That's Marlowe waiting at the five. Paul standing at the goal line. The kick from Jacob Brandstetter goes to the 5-yard line to Paul. He's hemmed in at the 20, somehow dances outside anyway, and a good return for Paul as he gets it up to the 28 or the 33-yard line. Good return. Brandstetter, the kicker, forced him out of bounds there.
Good patience that time by Paul, just kind of jitterbugging around here, just trying to find somewhere to go and waiting for his blocks to get set up. And you see him, he does a good job of setting up the blockers and then gets around the outside. And nice job, good field position to get started.
So they mark it up to the 34-yard line. Nice return of 29 yards for Niles Paul. Back in there, quarterback Taylor Martinez.
And you see today only three plays of 20-plus yards. And it's been really their ticket this year. And there goes Martinez. He runs it on the first play of the second half up to the 42-yard line. Ogontodu with the stop there, but a nice gain on first down.
I'm not sure if this is a read play here, and Taylor Martinez just keeps it because it looks like he's going backdoor anyway. So this is probably a design with a fake to Roy Helu Jr. coming across and getting Taylor Martinez back into action here. And I think he's still just trying to figure out what he can actually do on that ankle.
Mm-hmm. Gain of 8, second and 2. Martinez, boy, that ball popped up in the air. Somehow he was able to get it back and actually gained a yard.
Yeah, if there's one knock on Martinez that I've seen early in his career and this season here is that that ball does come out of his hands a little bit, especially in the running situation. You see that ball pop up there as the defender's making the tackle. That's Tobin Mopurum here, the young man who played running back for Kansas last year. He's got a couple of balls that he's knocked down and almost knocked that one out of his hands.
Gary, 32 fumbles for Nebraska this year, but they've only lost 11 of them.
Yeah, that's unique. The bouncers are coming their way. Oftentimes that doesn't happen so well. So taking care of the football is a priority for any football team.
Now on third and 1. Martinez keeps it himself, goes down the sideline, and is forced out by Chris Harris.
That's not the speed that Taylor Martinez has been displaying the rest of the season. And when I saw him break free, I'm saying, thinking to myself, this is a touchdown here. There's nobody going to have the leverage on speedy Taylor Martinez. He should turn the jets on right there, but there's not enough jet fuel, I think, in that right ankle.
An 18-yard gain, though, for Martinez. Ball down at the 39-yard line of KU. First down. Play action pass. Plenty of time. Now the pocket collapses and it'll be a sack. First one in there was Laptad.
And Laptad comes all the way around from the left side and gets to the back of the pocket. And you know, this is a long time in the pocket for Taylor Martinez. He steps up inside of it. And you see Laptad on the bottom of the screen. He's going to come up here to the top and go ahead and get Taylor Martinez from the backside.
So a sack for the Jayhawks and a loss of 5. Second down, 15 yards to go. This one picked off. Martinez had time, but he threw it right into the arms of Tyler Patman.
Yeah, Tyler Patman doing a good job there. You know, he's a nickelback. I talked about him earlier. He's got his second interception on the season for Patman. He's around the football. That's what he's done. He's been very active, and he's just in zone coverage, and you'll see him. He's just going to float back. I'm not sure Taylor Martinez expected him to drop back underneath that throw he's trying to get to Niles Paul there. Not a very good thrown ball. It looked like it might have been a little bit underthrown also, but Taylor Martinez, an interception here and giving Kansas an opportunity with one of those turnovers that I talked about to get some things started their way and for some momentum.
Morris Turner-Gill told Jim Rose, make plays.
Exactly.
And he made a play, Tyler Patman. So the Jayhawks take over. Fourth interception thrown by Martinez this year. Crowd gets into it as the Blackshirts come back on the field. Looking for their 6th sack of the night. And getting rid of it was Meekum, and that one was almost picked off. Mukamara looking for his first interception of the year.
Yeah, that's one thing about this Nebraska defense. You know, of all the guys that have had interceptions, they've got 15 in the season. Mukamara does not have one of those, and he's one of their top cornerbacks. And, you know, this is good pressure from the outside by Nebraska and trying to put Meekum unsettled there early, and this is a ball he probably should not have thrown. Should have thrown that ball away. Good coverage by Mukamara.
Trying to get it to Wilson. He really tried to force the ball in there. So second and 10. And the give here is to Quigley, trying to move that pile. He might have gained about 4 yards on the play. Steinkuhler and Crick sandwich him there.
That's one thing I don't know really about officials. You know, you see that pile moving? It looked like the pile was still moving, yet they blow the whistle.
Mm-hmm.
Well, it was the pile moves. I think you just give them the yards, right? Don't you just keep moving?
I would think so.
Maybe a little different.
Once the
rules,
forward
rules
progress is stopped, that's when you should blow the whistle. And they give him 4 yards on the carry and makes it 3rd and 6. Carl Pelini signaling in the call late to the defense. They have time, though, as OKU working out of the no huddle. Meekum will send Patterson in motion, and now a timeout taken by Kansas. So we'll take the timeout with them with 11:26 remaining. Kansas facing a third down when we come back. Welcome back to Lincoln. Taylor Martinez itching to get back on offense after throwing an interception, the fourth of the year and of his career. Nebraska leading at 14-0.
Yeah, he'd like to think his defensive mates, as the black shirts, can stop Kansas here. Now, Kansas is only one of seven on third downs in this football game, so they've got to find a way to get some first downs here to move against his defense. Has not been an easy task tonight.
One of seven on third down, 0 for 1 on that fourth down they tried on their first drive. They got the ball down to the 36-yard line. Tried it on fourth down, and Meekum was actually sacked on the play. So facing a third and six here. Meekum sacked again. This time, Jared Crick.
Well, just trying to get a little back out on a route, on a choice route, but it just doesn't have enough time to develop. Go one-on-one. Meredith, you see him there, and then Crick coming up the inside. Good job by the Huskers defense. Crick, that's his five. He's got 5.5 sacks now in the season, doing a good job.
Yeah, that's his second here tonight.
So it's actually 6.5 now. He had 4.5 coming into the ball game. Jared Crick with good pressure.
So the Jayhawks turn it over on downs again. Now they're 1 for 8 on third down. Good punt this time by Rojas, his best punt of the night. Kansas trying to down it on the goal line. Looks like they will. Wow, what an acrobatic play by Bradley McDougal.
Well, the officials are going to look at this on the side. Now, if he touches the in line with his foot, the ball can actually touch and go over. Not going to give it to him back. It's going to be a touchback. They're ruling as a touchback. So probably overruled there a little bit.
Yeah, great punt by Rojas, but it's going to go into the end zone. A 62-yard punt. He wished it was 61.
Well, here's the coverage. And is he shy of the goal line, or is there a toe on the line there? I can't tell from that angle. Maybe he did.
He tipped the toe.
Stepped right in.
Yep.
Good call by the officials. Sure. Well, they come up and they got a couple of them on the goal line there to look at it from both sides.
Boy, if he'd have let it go just a second earlier before he tipped that toe into the end zone. And this time the inside handoff to Helu, and he's able to get it up to the 24-yard line. Gain of 4. Helu rushed for 48 yards in the first half and a touchdown. The touchdown coming from 20 yards out.
Yeah, I've seen Roy Helu play this year, Dave, and I think that he is definitely healthy, and the speed that he has when he's broken through for these long runs over the 300-yard mark in one ball game this year, explosive runner, and I think he's really played very well this year for the Huskers.
Averaging better than 7 yards per carry this year. Here comes Helu again, going around the right side. He's got a first down and more, up to the 37-yard line.
I like it when a runner runs right on cue. We felt good about it. You know, he's running well, but is Taylor Martinez really healthy? You know, we've been watching tonight, and just how well is he? You know, you see him in this ball game, and is he stepping into these throws? Is he making as accurate a throw as he can? That ball a little bit outside, and this ball here going to be thrown across his body. Doesn't step into it and get a good throw, so that ball almost intercepted by them. And then in this last drive, he had the ability to sprint this through and I think break a big run, but not able to get that speed generated as he normally would.
This time, Martinez breaks outside. Looks like he had a little more spurt in his step that time, and he gets it up to the 45-yard line where Chris Harris makes the stop. You know, sometimes, too, when a guy is injured, Gary, they are a little tentative, and they're almost a little afraid to put some pressure on
him. I was about to say, Dave, I've had ankle injuries and played on them, and, you know, there's some days when you feel really good, and there's some times of the game you feel really good, and you feel like you can cut. Then there's others you just can't. So I think Taylor Martinez is learning now how to deal with this and really what he can accomplish. And it may not be full speed, but he's probably pretty close. And I think that's what Coach Delaney's seeing, thinking that he can continue to play and play through this and be a productive quarterback for this offense.
Well, it goes to midfield on that run, and it'll move the chains. Another first down for Nebraska. Drew Dudley with the stop right at midfield. First and 10, Nebraska at the 50-yard line. 8 minutes, 50 seconds remaining here in the third quarter. Nebraska got a 20-yard touchdown run from Helu in the second quarter. And at the very end of the first quarter, Rex Burkhead took it in from the Wildcat formation. First and goal from the five. Here comes Martinez. Boy, had one man to beat, and he was gone. Still, big run here for Martinez as he goes down to the 33.
Nice explosive run there inside, and he's just following his blockers in there, and he does. You know, he's got a pretty good little hole there, and you'll see him here. It's just a follow play. You got the fake in there to Helu, and Helu actually becomes a blocker, and then good job coming from the inside out, tackling Justin Springer, the middle linebacker. Otherwise, Taylor Martinez probably has a touchdown.
So another big gain for Nebraska. They've marched it all the way down to the 33-yard line. That was a 17-yard run. Martinez has now rushed for 57 yards in this game. Helu for 70. Helu cuts it back. Could not get out of the grasp of Chris Harris, or he had a lot of room on the outside.
You know, this offense here has really done a good job running, you know, with their offensive line doing a good job of blocking, and I think throughout the season here. So watch Mike Caputo, the center. He's right here, and watch him block out. And that's what you want from your offensive line. You want him to get on those blocks and get a cutback lane, and Roy Helu has a good job to be able to come back off that. So Caputo, he's the anchor there. He's the guy that gets them in their formations that they need to get into, and doing a pretty good job of leading up there.
Now Burkhead in there, and he's got the ball. Big hole on the left side. Burkhead takes it down to the 25-yard line. Greg Brown comes up from the secondary, and it'll be a third and two situation for Nebraska.
So when Sean Watson, the offensive coordinator, can put in Rex Burkhead and put in Roy Helu Jr., and you got him out there with Taylor Martinez, you got three guys that can really go.
Yeah, absolutely.
That's good stuff, and I like Burkhead's attitude. Now his aggressiveness, he plays physical. He just keeps churning and getting those extra yards.
He's rushed for 34 yards here today. Passing on third and two. Martinez throws it to the outside, and it is incomplete. Pass intended for Kyler Reed, and good coverage on the outside by Isaiah Barfield.
Yeah, just a one-man route there by Nebraska. The play action fake held everybody inside, and Kyler Reed, who's gotten down the field and made some plays for this defense, this offense here, has got four touchdowns on the year, and he can stretch the defense. He's got pretty good speed and ball a little bit outside.
I think that was actually a good throw by Martinez.
Yes.
Because Barfield was right there on the coverage. You underthrow that one, and it's a pick six.
Yeah, you got to throw it to the outside where your receiver can catch it, if anybody.
42-yard effort from Henry. Guess what? It's good.
Automatic.
He is unreal. 12 of 13 field goals this year. Tacks on three more and makes it 17-0.
.646, third quarter, Nebraska 17 and Kansas nothing. The Blackshirts have had a great night tonight. They've allowed just 42 yards, and this was a defense with a lot of pressure on it. This was a defense that was trying to live up to the standards that was set, were set a year ago. A fabulous defense a year ago, guys, with Ndamukong Suh, that transcendent player, Philip Dillard, Larry Asante, Matt O'Hanlon. These guys were just tremendously successful. And tonight, Nebraska's finally starting to get those statistics back. Five sacks of the quarterback already tonight. They had 20 coming into this ballgame. So either they're getting a whole lot better at what they intended to do, or, as we heard from the defensive coordinator, Carl Pelini, Gary and Dave, finally the experience is starting to show, because they lost a lot of experience from those aforementioned Huskers from a year ago.
I think that's right, Jim. Good point, too. And I think also getting Will Compton back in there linebacker and getting him at full strength, that really adds a lot to this defense. Big kick here by Adi Kanalik, and again trying to take it out of the end zone is DJ Bashirs, and he has stopped shy of the 20-yard line.
Now they don't want to let Bashirs get going, because he can make big plays in the kick return game. So good coverage by the Huskers.
Well, let's see if Quinn Meekum and company can get anything going as we watch this return again.
Nothing there. Good job.
The defense in the black shirts. Bo Pelini trying to urge this crowd on to get into it here. One thing you'll have to say, though, about Nebraska's defense here at home, the opponents have averaged just 10 points per game. The handoff and running outside. Sims, big hole for Sims and some good speed. Dennard finally makes the stop, but a big gain all the way up to the 38-yard line.
Offense.
Oh, it'll come back, a holding against KU.
Now that's why I got the corner. Probably a little holder on the outside. You haven't seen James Sims get break free yet this tonight. Take a look here on the bottom of the screen. Are we going to get up the hole here and on the right side? And Meredith, yeah, I think he's got a little cloth there. That's probably what the official's calling. So get his hands inside there. And
Sims has not been able to pick up where he left off against Colorado. Just 7 yards on the ground for Sims after gaining 123 with 4 touchdowns against the Buffaloes.
You're right, Dave. He has not been able to get on track. They have been able to utilize him the way they would like to have. And you got to credit the Nebraska defense. They've held everything in front of them, and they've made tackles here all over the field tonight.
So a first and 19. Meekum throws it down the middle of the field, and it's picked off. Dennard with another interception. His fourth of the year.
Well, we talk a lot about the secondary here for Nebraska. And this young man, Alfonso Dennard, has really come into his own, and one of the guys that Carl Pelini really sees has a really, really bright future. Alfonso Dennard does a good job in coverage, and I like his technique. He sees the receiver, he sees the quarterback, he sees, most importantly, the ball, and he makes a play on it. And when the ball's up in the air, defensive players have to have a mindset, it's my ball. And this is Alfonso Dennard going up and making a play on the football. And as you said, Dave, fourth interception of the year, and obviously a nice turnaround here and another huge play for this Nebraska defense.
Dennard coming back from that concussion, just giving Kansas a headache. So first down for Nebraska. They start this drive at their own 44-yard line. Martinez on a keeper. He fumbled the ball. Kansas says they have it. Johnson knocked the ball free. There's a mad scramble for it and still have not indicated yet.
You got Kansas players pointing like they've got the football. I'm not sure the officials. Yeah, one of the officials definitely did. They said, yes, it's Kansas football. Second ball now that Taylor Martinez has fumbled tonight. He had one pop up in the air and it came back right to him. And now this ball squarely out. And again, Steven Johnson coming up with a football. And, you know, just negating an interception. And they actually make yardage on the play on the exchange of plays here. Nebraska does with, Kansas does with better field position. You see the hit inside, and Johnson just takes the ball away. It bounces kind of back to him, and he jumps on top of it.
Well, you talk about making plays. You know, it really didn't come from the contact. Martinez was losing that ball really before he was hit. Now coming out of the Wildcat. On the keeper, busting it outside. Good run here. Dennard able to force out the runner as taking it all the way down inside the 30-yard line was Bradley McDougal, the wide receiver.
And McDougal's got shows his speed on the outside and pretty good misdirection there, allowing them to get that first down. And it's the best field position that Kansas has had tonight.
Putting Patterson in motion. McDougal again out of the Wildcat. And he takes it down to the 25-yard line. Jim?
You look at what has transpired against Nebraska defensively was illustrated on that last interception by Dennard. Dave and Gary, they are not throwing to Prince Amukamara's side. He doesn't have any interceptions, and yet he is expected to be a top 10 draft pick next spring. The only guy who's challenged him all year was Justin Blackman of Oklahoma State.
Not a good idea to challenge him either, but it's not a good bargain to go after Dennard.
And you got DJ Bashir's in the backfield here, and he gets bottled up by the Husker defense running inside. That's not going to be a place where you're going to get a lot of space there inside. I think that Kansas is going to have to find a way to work the edge here and hopefully find some space on the outside. I think Nebraska is too solid inside. He's taking a look at Mukamara here. He is one of the top cornerbacks, and they're not throwing at him for a reason because there's nobody open. Coach Gill, when he's seen the tape, he knows what a Mukamara can do. So probably talking to Chuck Long saying, hey, coach, we need to go the other way.
Meekum from the shotgun on 3rd and 7. Pocket breaks down. Meekum tripped up, or he might have had the first down. And a good play there by Meredith.
Yeah, Cameron Meredith just continued to the quarterback, and that's what you want from a defensive player. You want to use two words, relentless pursuit. And that's what Meredith, not watch him coming from the outside here. He pushes off the tackle, still in the heat of the battle there, trying to make a play and dives for the quarterback, Meekum, and gets him by the shoestrings. That's good effort.
Brandstetter will try a 42-yard field goal attempt here. Brandstetter is 7 for 11 on the year. His long on the year is 42 yards. Good snap, good hold, low kick, but he line drives the ball right through the uprights.
Banged it in there.
That was the fastest field goal I've ever seen from 42 yards.
Well, that's a good turn of events there for Turner Gill. Got points on the board after the turnover exchange and 3 points up there.
Jared Crick got a little piece of that ball and caused the flight to come down, but it still goes through for Jacob Brandstetter. You saw a little bit of waving wheat here in the Cornhusker State. So the Jayhawks are on the board thanks in large part to the second turnover by the Huskers here in the second half, an interception and a fumble by Taylor Martinez.
Yeah, those fumbles, they kind of, if you can avoid making them, obviously that's what you want to do. But I think Martinez, I talked about it, he's put some balls on the ground this year, and that's one of the things he's definitely got to work on and clean up. And if you come in here and you can play this football team, you need to take every advantage of those opportunities when you have a chance to get that football.
And I thought Turner Gill did a nice job there, and a little change up offensively. They go into the Wildcat.
Yeah, a little Wildcat, put some speed out there on the field, and don't necessarily always have to have your quarterback run the football. And Meekum, who's done a pretty good job, I think, of controlling the offense, he just had too much pressure on him. You know, there's nobody open in the secondary, and he just needs to find some plays that need to throw it away. And a couple of things they have not done here offensively for Kansas, they have not run the bootleg pass or got outside on the perimeter to try to throw the football. I'm not sure if that's in the arsenal of Quinn Meekum. A little bit, haven't seen enough of him yet to know if he's able to make that kind of a throw.
Carpellini's defense, with Kansas working from a short field, they force the Jayhawks to settle for the 3-point field goal. And now we'll see if this Nebraska offense can get rolling again. They've kind of had some spurts here tonight of some good offense, but they've sputtered a little bit too. Jacob Brandstetter, a senior out of Lawton, Oklahoma, will kick it off for the Jayhawks. Marlowe and Paul are back deep. 3:36 remaining here in the third quarter. And over end kick. Paul will take it at the 10. Cuts back. Big hole. Paul up to the 42-yard line. Brandstetter.
Yeah.
How many times have the kickers made a play on special teams here tonight?
Good athletes, they've got to make them. You know, they're one of those guys out there that's got to get them down. When you're the last resort, you've got to do it. And now's Paul running fast and hard. Great position, though, up at the 42-yard line. Nebraska's going to get started again.
Let's see how Martinez comes out after throwing an interception this half, plus fumbling the ball. Alou back there with him. And Halu fumbles the ball. It's still on the ground. Kansas says they have another fumble recovery.
Martinez is right in the area. He went down for the loose ball, and maybe Kansas got another one here. Roy Halu Jr. had the ball inside. It's going to be second down. Looks like Taylor Martinez may have gotten that ball. And wow, almost a disaster there for Nebraska with the first snap on this series. Take a look here. Junior Roy Halu comes in there, and the ball is knocked out by one of the defensive linemen, Laptad. Jake Laptad knocked that ball loose, and that was, I think it was Taylor Martinez that actually came up with it.
It was. And it all goes for a 3-yard gain. That's what we're talking about, though. All the fumbles this year for Nebraska, they've been fortunate to get many of them back. Burkhead is now in there. Burkhead from the Wildcat, and he loses a couple of yards. Good play defensively. Coming in, Opura. He comes in to make the stop.
Good opportunity here for Kansas now to assert themselves defensively, keep this play in front of them. You got third and 9, a little over 9 yards to go here for the first down. So Carl Torbush, defense coordinator, got to find a way to keep Nebraska at bay here and force the fourth down in a punting situation.
Even though they lead by 14, you'd have to say this crowd is a bit antsy right now.
Crossing route.
And on that crossing route, Paul's got it, but he is hauled down well shy of the first down marker by Anthony Davis.
Well done by Davis getting out there and catching up to a speedy receiver coming across the field. And you know, I saw it coming up here from top. And they want to get some rub off here with the two guys crossing. Watch as the receivers cross. There's one underneath, one there. And it's man coverage, but a good job by Davis going behind and getting out of the traffic and coming up and making the tackle on Miles Paul.
We've talked a lot about the black shirts, the Nebraska defense, but how about the Kansas defense, especially here in the second half? They have stymied the Nebraska Cornhuskers. 1:38 remaining here, and here we are, 3-3 really in the third quarter. Let's check out some highlights, or lowlights, as it were. Henry with an automatic 42-yard field goal for him.
Now, Taylor Martinez, you know, he's throwing the ball here, and the ball's intercepted by the defense of Kansas, and that's his first turnover, obviously. So, obviously, you have a chance here to get things happening. And then another fumble caused here. Taylor Martinez puts it on the ground, and Kansas gets that. And now you get turn that around, and guess what? You get 3 points for Kansas. So, a couple of turnovers here by Nebraska helping Kansas's cause.
Now the Jayhawks start at their own 17. The handoff here to Sims. He runs around the right side and gains about three, gets it up to the 20-yard line where Gomes and David make the stop there.
You know, when you've got the secondary that Nebraska has and you can lock up here on the outside and you can commit, as Carl Pelini's doing, a lot of players in the box to take care of the run game, that's when you're going to be able to be successful. And I think that's what we're seeing here is that the Nebraska defense, you're seeing eight players around the box here consistently against this Kansas running game.
You know, they just rely on the single coverage. Wait, timeout coming. This is a dead play here on the field.
Prior to the snap, timeout Nebraska. It is their first of the half. 30 seconds.
I don't think Bo or Carl liked their defense that they were in on that particular play, and they called a timeout. 1:03 remaining here in the third quarter. So Carl Pelini giving his defense an earful right now. They get ready to go back onto the field. And speaking of on the field, here's Jim Rose.
Yeah, Dave, you look at Carl and you look at the black shirts playing a very good ball game here tonight. But this is a very competitive football team, especially in that secondary. You look at two major personnel changes. Austin Cassidy and Courtney Osborne are out there instead of Ricky Tenars and P.J. Smith. Why? Tackling. Why? Technique. This is a defense that is expected to excel and be perfect on every play, and that's one of the reasons they have such high standards.
Yeah, Cassidy, Jim, a former walk-on. Of course, his dad is with the Texas A&M staff, and Cassidy decided to stay here. Cassidy in on that stop along with Levante David.
Yeah, so third down and short here now for Nebraska defensively. Can they stop Kansas from getting this first down and get back off the field?
David, by the way, nearing double figures in tackles again. He's averaging better than double figures in tackles this year. The leading tackler in the Big 12.
He's done a good job around the football. Very, very active linebacker.
Third and two. And breaking through the line and getting the first down is James Sims. Good hard running by the freshman.
Good first down there for Kansas, trying to move the chains and get first downs. I think they feel like they're competitive here in this football game, and you never know. They can get some more points here early in this, you know, with this quarter, and have plenty of time left in this football game. Looks like the quarter's about to expire here, so this might be the last play we've seen.
That makes the Jayhawks, by the way, 2 of 10 on third down conversions here in this game. So the third quarter has come to a close. That third quarter, each team getting a 42-yard field goal. Memorial Stadium is where we are. Another sellout crowd on hand here in Lincoln, Nebraska. We go to the fourth quarter with the Huskers leading it 17-3. K can't imagine that Bo Pelini is very happy right now. His team heavily favored in this game, and yet they only have a 2-touchdown lead against the Kansas Jayhawks. This crowd kind of sitting on their hands through that third quarter. It was marred by a couple of turnovers by the Huskers.
Now, we talked about the beginning of this football game that Kansas, you know, defensively, they were allowing over 200 yards a ball game. Not a very good defensive effort coming into this ball game, that they were allowing a lot of yards rushing, and Nebraska being able to run the ball consistently, that's going to be their mantra all year. Haven't been giving up those big explosive long runs to Nebraska's offense. So I think the KU defense has really done a pretty good job here of negating huge plays by Nebraska.
Kansas will come out running that Wildcat again. McDougal is behind center from the shotgun. Coming in motion is Patterson. And they try to run it up the middle, but Pierre Allen was right there defensively. Allen, a 3-year starter, very physical player on the outside for the Huskers.
And he's had a nice season for Nebraska, and obviously his senior season, and trying to make an impact there inside.
So a gain of 8. Or gain of 2, excuse me, second and 8. Sims again trying to go into that pile. They'll move it a little bit. And now the forward progress stopped at the 35. Steinkuhler was able to stop the pile and move it back the other way. Kansas today, total yards 79 offensively.
Well, I think that Carl Pelini's got a decision to make here. Does he roll up the pressure and bring perimeter pressure? Pressure on the quarterback Meekum as he's trying to throw the football and get a first down here. 3rd and 5, a little over 5 yards here, it looks like. So see what Carl Pelini dials up here defensively.
It's 2 of 10 KU on 3rd down. On 3rd and 5, they throw a little flare pass that is incomplete, intended for James Sims, but beyond his reach.
Yeah, and he wouldn't have been getting the first down anyway, because Levante David was tracking him and had coverage, you know, about a yard away from him. So the ball not able to be caught by James Sims. Pretty throw a little bit behind him by Quinn Meekum.
And a tough day for Meekum, as he is 3 for 10 through the air. And an interception as well. Burkhead standing back at his 25-yard line. Low line drive kick from Rojas. I'm saying it hit a Kansas player way up at the 35-yard line, but they're right for the moment anyway, marking it at the 24. Now they're moving the ball up.
First spot of what's called illegal touching by the kick team. That's where they'll bring it back and set it down at the 35. You see the beanbag thrown out there by the officials. They marked the first spot where illegal contact was made.
And they didn't miss it. So good field position here for Nebraska. Let's see if they can do something with it. Burkhead is behind Martinez. Right now is under center. Now he'll go back shotgun. Burkhead, nice move to the outside. He has Greg Brown to beat, and Brown stood his ground, but still a nice game as Brown shoves him out at the 49, a gain of 14.
Good job by Burkhead getting around the edge, and see his speed, pretty impressive. And with that run, it looks like that's pretty good stuff.
He's up to 45 yards on the day.
Shifty looking.
Shifty and then powerful at the edge. This is where they scored that touchdown, the 20-yard touchdown, when they send both tight ends to the right. And Burkhead, following those guys, is able to get it down to the 45-yard line, a gain of 6 more.
Nebraska starting to run the football. They're up over 160 yards rushing, 180 yards rushing on the day. So starting to get this machine going a little bit.
Second down, 4 yards to go. They need to reach the 40 for the first down. And no gain here. Justin Springer was right there defensively. Another Patman also comes in. And getting up slowly from the pile is Keith Williams.
Big Keith Williams, 6'5", 310-pound guard. They're getting up slow, and this Kansas defense has been up and down a little bit here. This is when they need to make a stand. You got a third down situation. You can get off the field to get the ball back to your offense. Still plenty of time in this ball game. 12 minutes to go.
Nebraska 50%, as you see, on third down, 6 of 12 today. So facing a third and four here. Here comes the blitz. Martinez looked like he had picked it up. Pass intended for Cotton. It was tipped, and it falls incomplete.
But if you watch Taylor Martinez's body language and how he's just completely unsettled back there when he sees the pressure, when he sees the blitz, although it is picked up, as you said, Dave, he just wasn't very confident right there in the backfield as, you know, getting this throw away. And he probably threw the ball a lot earlier than he needed to, and not a good throw at all.
So Henry will try to pin the Jayhawks inside the 20 here. And he's angling it for the corner. A perfect kick, really, as Patterson with the fair catch at the 9. Great kick again by Henry. Again, continues to be a weapon. Nebraska leads by only 14 here in Lincoln.
11:41 in the ballgame. The Huskers leading 17-3. And Levante David, number 4, the junior college transfer, has had a magnificent game. He's had a very, very good season. And if you think back to the last really big game he had, it was in the National Junior College Championship game last year. He was playing for Fort Scott against Blinn Junior College of Texas, which has been in the headlines lately, guys, because their quarterback was Cam Newton. And in that game, which was barely won by Blinn and Newton, David had nearly 20 tackles. He was just a monster on the field. And you look at this game, you might have the National Defensive Player of the Year, Levante David, and Newton, the National Offensive Player of the Year for Auburn. You never know.
Yeah, if he survives all the turmoil.
Yeah.
Thanks, Jim. Not David, but Cam Newton. David has no controversy surrounding him at all. 19 tackles earlier this year against South Dakota State. Meekum held on to the ball, and then you could just see him lower his shoulder like, uh-oh, this is going to hurt. And he takes it up to the 15, a gain of 6.
Well, that's kind of the bootleg pass here, misdirection pass, that I wanted to see if Quinn Meekum had that in his arsenal to get outside of the pocket and throw. Nobody open, though, in the secondary, and he has to pull the ball down and run with it.
Meekum 3 of 10 and through the air today. Look at that, only 88 yards allowed. It's the least this season, and it's a closing in on a record. But they still have 11 minutes to go. And remember, according to Kansas, the fourth quarter belongs to them.
Well, they're not going to find any yardage right in there with Steinkuhler and Jared Crick. They're running right in their kitchen. That's not going to happen.
Kind of like
the Williams brothers in the NFL with the Vikings. There's no real estate there.
No, that's right. Give David a half tackle on that play as well. So third down, 3 yards to go. David urging on this sellout crowd here at Memorial Stadium to help him out. And they do. Pass is incomplete, no flags. Patterson thought that perhaps Gomes had a hold of him, but no flag on the play. And again, another failed third down conversion for KU.
Yeah, DeJon Gomes is one of those safeties that can just make play after play after play. He's always around the ball and good technique, leverage on the inside out. No need to turn him and put your hand on the receiver to turn him. Just get your hand out there and knock that ball away. Nice play.
So Alonzo Rojas will be punting it from near his own goal line. Burkhead is waiting for it at his own 40. Low kick. Burkhead comes up. Fair catch right at midfield. That's a good play by Burkhead. Hate it when those guys back there receiving punts let the ball drop. And that on a line drive kick, he knew he could come up, and that saves you 10 or 15 yards.
Yeah, that ball is just going to bound away. That's what the punter's trying to get accomplished. He's kicking low, keep it out of his hands, and so he can't retrieve it or receive it. Good job, as you said, by Burkhead. Smart play coming up and catching the football.
Only a 34-yard punt. Great field position now for Taylor Martinez and company. Let's check out some other scores from the Big 12, and of course, big night game going on between Oklahoma State and Texas. And in that one, the Cowboys have the lead in Austin, 16-3. Baylor Boy, that's huge for the Baylor Bears against Texas. A&M has been coming on strong with a win last week against Oklahoma.
Yeah, a huge win there potentially for Baylor in that football game. You see the Oklahoma State score. Guess what? Mr. Dan Bailey, automatic PAT, missed a PAT in that football game. So, Mr. Henry, he's tied with you now as far as PATs missed. You know, those two guys as kickers in the Big 12 Conference, you know, I've watched them a long time, and they're two of the best I've seen. But one got away from Dan Bailey tonight.
Hmm. I don't know, might have been blocked. I didn't see it. We weren't watching that game. Did you have that one out of the corner of your eye there?
I actually kind of peeked a little bit and, you know, kind of saw what happened there. They scored a touchdown, Oklahoma State did, and Dan Bailey kicked a low ball, and it did get knocked down.
And by the way, while we wait for Nebraska to come out on offense, they're coming out now. I want to say get well wishes to Lee Barfneck, who's one of the great writers in the country for the Omaha World Herald, had hip replacement surgery recently. So, Lee, we wish you the best and get well soon. So this one, the Wildcat formation now for the Huskers. Burkett on a keeper, and he takes it down to the 42-yard line. Nice gain of 8. Harris and Dorsey sandwich him there, but a gain of 8 yards for Burkett. And he is now 60 yards rushing here tonight.
Burkett's got it in his arsenal to throw that ball. He seems pretty poised back there when he runs that Wildcat. So if you ever get that little extra wrinkle in there, it could be really difficult for defenses to defend.
Former quarterback out of Plano, Texas. Burkett did a good job of waiting for the blocks to develop. Turned right and moves the pile down to the 37. Another first down. Laptad with the tackle.
Not much of an up-tempo attitude here for Nebraska. Just going back to the huddle, taking their time, being pretty methodical on how they're doing things tonight.
Fresh set of downs, first down, ball at the 37.
Tight end move.
Yep, there was some movement. A little bit early, this will cost him 5.
Prior to the snap, false start, number 25, offense. 5-yard penalty, still first down.
That's Kyler Reed, who is a sophomore out of Shawnee, Kansas. He has great speed as a tight end.
Yeah, he's 230-pound tight end. Watch on the left side of your screen, or he's just going to pick his hand up, which is what he does, and a little early. They're averaging, you know, 27.7 yards per reception Reed was tonight coming into this ball game. See the rushing that Nebraska's done today, or on the season, compared to tonight what they've got.
Burkett trying to bust out of a tackle, but he couldn't get out of the arms of Chris Harris. Short tackle by Harris. Limits the gain to 3. Ball spotted at the 40-yard line. Actually, gain of only 2, and it's second down and 13 yards to go.
Not even 100 yards of offense for Kansas tonight, and Nebraska just continuing to try to move the chains.
Martinez handing off, and Burkett is thrown out of bounds by Harris. He's able to get it past the 35, ruled out at the 33. Jim?
We thought at the top of the show, guys, that Nebraska might run more Wildcat. And with the temperature dropping, I think they're afraid of Taylor's ankle really beginning to stiffen up. And look for more of Dontrevious Robinson. If the Huskers continue in this set, he's number 27. He was in position to be a first-string running back at the start of the year, but he's not as good in this formation running the ball. So let's see what they do with him.
Martinez with a good catch by Niles Paul. That ball was a little bit high, but Paul able to haul it in, and he takes it down to the 26 for a first down.
Yeah, second tough catch tonight by Niles Paul. One earlier in the ball game across the middle that he went up high to get in. And watch this one up there high also, and he's going to pull it in. And also got to remember that he's going to be contacted too from the inside out by the defender. So well done. And here's Dontrevious Robinson in the ball game. Right on cue there, Mr. Jim. Good job.
Dontrevious Robinson in there in the Wildcat with Rex Burkhead. Burkhead, he's following Robinson. And is spun down at the 25, a gain of only 1. And Justin Springer there.
Yeah, you know, I agree with the philosophy here for taking Taylor Martinez out of the backfield. Don't put the pressure on him. Use your other players and do that. You're firmly in command of this football game. Just churn out first downs.
And they really like Robinson, guys. He does a lot for the ball club, but he had difficulty with the zone read. That was just not his cup of tea. So they're looking for a way to get Robinson back on the field. And so you might see more and more of that as Taylor tries to recover from his injury.
Well, I think it just comes with experience, Jim. You've got to be able to get to coming across the backfield and come underneath and take that ball from the quarterbacks. We see a flag thrown here. Probably going to get a holding penalty inside on the Huskers. But that is obviously a play that they're going to run, you know, continually here at Nebraska. So I think that Dontravius is going to have to find a way to figure that out if he doesn't understand it right now.
Absolutely. And he had difficulty holding onto the ball at times last year. So they were looking for something that he could wrap his arms around as he grows in the offense. And if you look at some of the guys on the football field, there's a relative amount of inexperience in the offensive backfield. Burkhead is a second-year sophomore. Martinez is a redshirt freshman. So it is, I think, to some degree, still very much a work in progress, although Bo wouldn't allow that as an excuse. He'd say, wait a minute, we're 10 games in. It ought to be a lot better than this.
But you know what? The results that they're getting this year offensively, remember, just think last year, what was going on with Nebraska's offense? They couldn't do anything.
Right.
This year, it's just been just the opposite. You've had explosive plays every single week, and that's what we've become to expect from Nebraska. And, you know, this is a win here. This might be a close win. If it's, you know, 17-3, you would expect that they could have done a lot better against Kansas. And some of the pollsters perhaps looking at this and seeing how Nebraska may not have had a big of output as they normally would have.
And I think the key, Gary, is the big play. The Nebraska offense simply did not have that big play last year.
They did not.
And this year, clearly with Martinez, that dimension is there on any snap. And it's really opened up some things for Roy Helu as well. We're probably not going to see much of him yet today, but there's a talented receiver, Quincy Anunua, a really, really gifted receiver who's a true freshman who's really rising on the charts with his offense, too.
Yeah, he is, Jim. He's only made one catch, but Sean Watson was telling us that he is really coming on Anunua. Perfect pass this time, right on target. Kinney takes it in to that 11-yard line for a first down. That was more like it. We haven't seen many big plays today from the Husker. That's the one thing that's really been missing from their arsenal, but this was a really good play here on third down.
Just done a little slant route here. Kenny comes inside, and he just outruns or takes away the ability for the defender to tackle him, and he just goes, bounces right off of that. Isaiah Barfield not able to pull him down, so good job and a good throw by Martinez.
17-yard throw. He's up to 134 yards passing here today, 12 of 22, and that one interception. Burkhead again from the Wildcat. And again, Kansas does a good job to string that play out. Greg Brown forced him out of bounds for no gain.
Nebraska come into this ball game averaging, just about 442 yards per ball game, and done it in a myriad of ways. And tonight, 356 yards total offense tonight is see Burkhead here get bounced out of bounds. So a little shy of their numbers. Kansas, you know, doing what they can to slow them down, but it's still been an offense that really has a lot of weapons. And especially when you talk about putting Taylor Martinez at the quarterback spot as a defender, that's something you have to deal with the quarterback that can both run it and throw it.
Second down, 9 yards to go. Helu bounces outside and then is tackled by Greg Brown inside the 10. He goes to the 7.
Greg Brown doesn't have anything but he could do his tackling. Roy Helu ran right into his chest, and okay, that's where I'm going. I'm going to just run right through you. Greg Brown giving up a few biscuits to him. He's about 20 pounds light on that little war.
So a third down and 5 yards to go. They can pick up a first down at the 2. Martinez looking into the end zone, and it's almost picked off. The pass was intended for Kenny, and he overthrew his target.
Well, what does Kenny do? Kenny comes inside, but guess what he does? He stops on the route, and this is Martinez throwing to where he expects him to go. Watch Kenny come inside. You got to keep coming in here, because that's where the ball is going to be thrown. And it's just a little misconnection there on the quarterback and the receiver as far as what they both expect from each other. I think Taylor Martinez expected him to continue on the route.
So it'll be a chip shot field goal for Alex Henry. He'll spot it down at the 14. He makes it a 24-yard effort. And the kick is good. So two field goals in this game for Alex Henry. And he adds three more on the board for the Nebraska Cornhuskers. Plus, that drive ate up a lot of time, only 3:44 remaining.
Just 3:44 left in the ball game. Nebraska and Kansas. Huskers out in front 20-3. It's been a good night for Niles Paul after a very, very bad week. We saw what happened in the ball game at Iowa State and made a big mistake on a kickoff return, bringing it out deep, but then also turning it over and led to a big Iowa State score. We talked about how the expectations on this kid were really, really high. At one time, when he was such a gifted high school football player, he would routinely see triple team coverage, two corners and a safety covering Niles Paul when he was at Omaha North High School. He was a parade All-American, led the West team in the U.S. Army All-Star game. He only has 5 touchdowns in his career. He wants to get that number up here at the end. 4 of them last year, just 1 this year. But if he can just get the consistency, we've seen that here tonight, guys, that'll really be a big plus for Nebraska.
And Alec kicking it to Bashirs, who takes it from the goal line. Trips over the 20 and gets it up to the 27-yard line. 6 catches today, by the way, for Niles Paul. He's had a very, very good game and made a couple of really tough catches.
Yeah, we talked about Nebraska and what's ahead of them. And, you know, being ranked 8th in the BCS. And, you know, I think this is one of the things that's going to plague Nebraska as far as perhaps moving up in the rankings and even a chance to squeak into perhaps a national championship picture. It's their non-conference opponents. They beat Western Kentucky, Idaho, Washington State, and South Dakota. But really, those records for those teams have not played very well. They're combined 12-24. So the non-conference not playing in the favor with the pollsters, you see here as they're rolled into now as number 8 in the BCS. So I think that's going to take a factor. So they need to have convincing wins. This is a good win against Kansas. And if they can keep it to under 100 yards, an impressive win against the Jayhawks defense, doing a good job against their offense, slowing them down.
I'll also make this point. That loss against Texas hurt in a lot of ways. I mean, they would be up there in the top 2 or 3 right now in the BCS without that loss. Plus, Texas this year is not the Texas we've been used to, and a loss to Texas this year really costs you in terms of points on the computer.
Yeah, you know, those non-conference wins and then that loss to the team that really, as you said, Dave, not playing very well, and they've got 5 losses themselves. So
let me ask you a question about this game in particular. What does this say? Is it sort of, all right, the Nebraska offense hasn't had the big plays, they haven't been as good as we have seen in the past, or is it, hey, Kansas is starting to make some progress?
I think there's a little of both. Kansas is making progress. You know, Carl Torbush, the defense coordinator, played decent, got their guys playing decent. Hey, Nebraska still has got over 360 yards of total offense in this game. Sure, it's not been the explosive plays that we're used to seeing. We get spoiled, I think, with Nebraska getting those huge plays from scrimmage, just have not come today. But hey, they've done what they needed to and get inside the red area, they have scored.
When you look at that upcoming schedule, we kind of assume that Nebraska will be in that Big 12 championship game, but that hasn't been decided quite yet. They are in the driver's seat, but Missouri with a win today against Kansas State keeps them at least in the conversation. And of course, if Nebraska wins out, then they will be in that championship game, and it looks like right now they're going to be playing Oklahoma State.
Yeah, Oklahoma State in this ball game here doing pretty well against Texas. They've got a lead against them in the second quarter, 23-3. So Cowboys look like they're set pretty well, but they're going to have Oklahoma to deal with still at the end of the year for perhaps the Big 12 South Conference.
This one batted up in the air and incomplete, and now Meekum is just 3-for-13 in this game after going 12-for-12 in the second half against Colorado.
Yeah, 17-of-17 of his last throws there in that ball game, inclusive. So, you know, just not the night tonight, you know.
And I think Huskers, that has a lot to say about the Huskers defensively. Yeah. Their coverage in the secondary and the pressure they're putting on from that front 5.
They just had 89 yards of total offense the Jayhawks do tonight. And this defense, the secondary, I think, has played outstanding. It's allowed the pass rush to really eat up, you know, what the quarterback is able to do. And so Meekum has had a hard time to get things going because of a very, very good Nebraska defense.
Almost sacked again. Rolling out, and he will be sacked. That's a loss of a couple. It'll count as another sack. Will Compton, the middle linebacker, he makes the stop.
And actually lost a yard on that play, so going backwards the other way, it looks like 88 yards now for going to be for Kansas. And nobody's open down the field. That's the problem. That's why you can't throw it. And then the rush gets to him finally and breaks it down and make him nowhere to go with the football.
Bayhawks 2 of 13 on third down conversions here tonight. Well, Burkhead waiting for it at his own 35-yard line. Those low kicks, and it takes a Jayhawk bounce. Everybody gets away from it, and it'll be downed at the 29-yard line. So 2:39 remaining. Nebraska's got this game in hand. We'll see if they just kind of run some plays and try to run the clock out.
And I would imagine that timeouts would be used by Turner Gill in this situation to preserve some time on the clock. But you know what? Their offense has not shown any ability to make any plays down the field or to give you an impression that they can score and very quickly and put some points up there quickly.
In the last 2 years, Nebraska's defense one other time has allowed 109 yards of total offense. That was against Arizona. Bo Pelini's team and Carl Pelini, his brother, their defense has held Kansas under 100 yards of total offense here in this game.
The Huskers and Jayhawks each have two timeouts remaining, so I would expect that Kansas, if they stop Nebraska short of the first down, would expect the timeout to be called by Turner Gill.
But a gain of five there. It's second and five. Hand off here to Halu, and he might have gotten back to the line of scrimmage. Jake Lapted with another stop.
Well, I'm really surprised they're not calling the timeout. Really surprised that we're not seeing a timeout here, because your defense is third down. You can get off the field unless you're trying to save your timeouts for your offense, but you're just giving up 35 seconds here to the offense and 20 seconds still remaining on the play clock, so you're going to have about a minute and 20 when this is snapped. I think Martinez, he's on his game, he should be snapping his ball with one or two seconds left on the clock.
First throwing here, and another first down catch by Brandon Kinney, and he goes out of bounds near midfield.
Now forget everything I just said. It's all about getting a first down and moving the sticks here. And Brandon Kinney making a nice grab here beyond the first down marker, and Taylor Martinez putting it right on his numbers. Good throw.
386 yards of total offense for the Huskers. 87 yards of total offense for the Jayhawks. Six sacks tonight by that black shirt defense. Gain of only a couple of yards. Clock continues to move. Kansas not using any timeouts.
What are Taylor Martinez's numbers, Dave, tonight?
Martinez, 13 of 24 through the air for 150 yards, and he has rushed for 71 yards.
Wow, didn't see the 71 yards. It just adds up. I did not see that tonight. Mm-hmm. Just shows you what kind of plays he's making, and that's below his season average. You
know, he's rushed 11 times, and he's still averaging almost seven yards per carry. And he hasn't had that explosive run here
just
today.
I've not seen a big run from him.
On play action, going to throw it here. And Paul is open and he hangs on despite taking a vicious hit from Barfield.
I'm wondering here, Sean Watson just said, okay, we're going to go ahead and play our game plan and just to call the plays that we think we can work and continue to get better at. And Taylor Martinez with a nice strike down the field. So now, Brask, is that going to get him over 400 yards in total offense? I think it probably will, or get close to it anyway. It's a nice throw here to Paul inside.
Chance for them to work a little bit on two-minute offense. Clock winding down, nearing 20 seconds. And play action. Martinez dances around the pocket. Throws just behind the line of scrimmage, and it is incomplete. Good play defensively again by Patman.
Trying to get the ball down the field. And you know, Martinez is obviously one of those special athletes that you like to have on your program, and obviously going to improve as a quarterback in different facets of his game, but his ability with his legs and his athleticism is what really makes him go.
And I think with his legs, his athleticism, a lot of times just quarterbacks that can run as well as he does, they don't have the kind of arm he has. I think he's got a good arm. He needs to become more accurate, but he's got a good strong arm.
Russ called the timeout here. Is that what I'm hearing?
Yep.
The Maybe they're asking Alex Henry if he wants to try to kick one.
Well, if he did, 50-ish. It would be a 50-yarder. There would be some who would think, all right, is that tacking on a Turner Gill? I don't know.
I don't think that both of them would attempt a field goal here. It's not in his character.
Again, I think there's two sides of this equation here, and I think one of them is, look, we're trying to run some offense here to see what we can do late in the game, and now they're going to just say, that's it. We're done. We've proved what we wanted to prove here today. We're just going to take a knee and let the clock wind out. It's a win for the Huskers, maybe not as impressively as some thought it would be here today, but again, I think Kansas had a lot to say about that. Their defense stepped up and played a pretty good game.
Yeah, they were solid early on. They definitely did. But Nebraska overall, they made the plays they needed to, move the ball down the field. Still did a good job. Almost 400 yards of total offense. I think it finished up around 397, if the numbers are right I'm seeing here. So pretty good job, I think, by Bo Pelini's bunch. And, you know, for Turner Gill coming back to Memorial Stadium, warm welcome, but obviously a situation where his football team just lacking a little bit of the talent that he needs to be competitive here. And so this is the last installment of this series between Kansas and Nebraska in the Big 12.
And for Bo Pelini, as the Huskers go to 9-1 on the year, his team has won at least 9 games all 3 years he has been the head coach of the Huskers. And he joins Bob Devaney, Frank Solich, and Tom Osborne in that group of guys that have started their career at Nebraska with at least 9 wins in their first 3 years.
I like Bo Pelini. He's a football coach.
Yes.
There's nothing but, and he's a guy that he's got some principles. He's got a way of doing things, a defensive guy. And I think it's a good formula for success.
Jim?
Bo Pelini, the winning coach here tonight. You'd have to be awfully picky to find something wrong with his defensive performance.
Well, we played well defensively, but we gotta pick it up on in some of the other phases. We were a little bit sloppy, and it's a win. And it's time to go to the next one. Got a big test coming up next week.
What are those phases in particular?
Oh, just we got to be more efficient. We weren't efficient enough, and too many mistakes. But we won. It's time to move on to the next one.
Sack total really up tonight, Bo, especially if you look at the average over the first 9 ball games. What was the difference?
Our guys played well. We had a mix of four-man pressure and some blitzes, and our guys covered well down the field to give our it was a good solid performance defensively. You don't hold somebody to under 100 yards without playing good football.
Best performance defensively since that Arizona win. Really very strong.
Yeah, we played well, and we just got to carry it over and make sure we keep getting better.
What do you think the secret is to that, carrying it over, getting a performance consistently like this every week?
Well, I mean, that's a challenge. It's a challenge that you see it across the country. You see people getting knocked off and upsets and everything else. You just got to keep going, and it's November, and you got to keep pressing forward.
You spent just one season working with Turner, and he was on the offensive side of the ball when you were an assistant at Nebraska. What did you just say to Coach Gill after the game?
I said good luck.
Very good. Thanks, Bo.
Thanks, Jim.
That's Coach Bo Pelini, fellas. Nebraska gets a win, and now we have Levante David, linebacker. Talk about your performance tonight. This was a dominant defensive performance. You ever played a game collectively as well as the team did here tonight?
We just keep improving, you know. Like, our game plan was to shut these guys out. You know, we knew what we was capable of doing. You know, we just came out here and played our right assignments, did what we had to do, and we just had one of the 100 yards, which was great on our part.
Overall, your ball game from the get-go, Levante, you were making plays early in the contest. Do you think that set the tone for the other guys?
Everybody just looking for somebody to, you know, just feed off of, you know, energy. I try to do that every game, you know. Everybody just, if one guy make a play, everybody just going to get hyped and try to make plays, you know. And that's what I try to bring every game.
I got to ask you, you chased Cam Newton around the football field in the National Junior College title game. You been thinking about him much this week with all that's going on?
No, I know, man. I just feel like they're trying to mess with him because he's a great football player, you know. He's doing great things at Auburn, you know. And I take my hat off to him, you know, he's a great football player. You know, all I can just say is wish him the best, and I hope he keep improving.
You think you can put this defensive performance back on the field 3 more times, 4 more times this season?
We just got to go get in the film room, man, see what we can get better on all aspects of the game. You know, we'll see.
All right, Levante, nice ball game.
Thank you.
Levante David leads Nebraska's performance here tonight. It was a dominant performance, 87 total yards, just 5 first downs by the Kansas Jayhawks. Dave and Gary will wrap it up from Chili Memorial Stadium right after you.